Okay.
Do we have a quorum?
We have, let's open the planning board meeting for Monday, October 24th, 2016. I'd like to thank HCAM for recording the meeting today. Right now we have two members that are out. They will have to watch the tape if they're going to vote on the hearing in the future. We're expecting one or more of our members here. Maybe he'll be showing up, but presume you want to go ahead, ask that first before after the other announcements. Go ahead with the hearing.
Yeah, it's a simple majority for the site plan.
Correct.
So I'm fine with the presentation, and I hope the board members will participate in the future and do the tape. So
okay. Basically, tonight we're going to have a 7:30 hearing on a additional building on South Street. And then at 8 o'clock we have some residents, and Elaine is coming in. We may continue, because we only gave a half an hour for the first one, we may continue that till after these residents come in. If we'd like to at least leave the applicant today with a bunch of action items or questions that might need to be answered, so that we're clear on that, so that we can expeditiously move towards approval at probably another meeting. I'd like to note for the members that November 21st is our public hearing on the master plan. Announcements have gone out to a lot of committees. I heard back from one committee that they're going to put it on their agenda, so that was good.
And we've already received comments from the senior center back.
Great. So we're starting to get feedback on that. That is in just a little bit less than a month from now, on the 21st of November. And all the public are welcome to go there. It is online. The draft is online at our on our town webpage somewhere.
There is a hard copy at the library.
A hard copy at the library. Okay, and then the last announcement is you guys are willing to pass this down and around to trick-or-treat time. And
that's a sweet announcement.
So anyway, we'll have a kind of a sugar.
Sure. I think we can all
It's a sugar high.
Now you know the candy is definitely part of a CrossFit diet.
Well, I'll have to have you talk to my cardiologist. But, okay, so I think 7:30 is here. Why don't you two guys come on up?
I know that I'm going to get further away from most of you there with that board. I don't mind holding this. You, the representative from Beta?
Yes. Yeah.
Okay, do you mind if I just keep my back to you and do this where the board can see the board better?
Well, it's between that.
It's also for TV, though.
Right. Oh, where's the TV?
Right here.
TV comes right here. So.
Oh, then fine. I didn't even know we were on TV.
Oh, yeah. So, anyway.
All of that was for our consumption.
Okay, let's open the public hearing. This is an application for site plan review.
David, can you get it right behind Jen?
This is Fort Point Management, LLC, Western Partners Acquisition Group, LLC, and this is for 45 South Street. It's a proposal to construct a new 10,200-foot square foot commercial building with some parking and associated site work. This is behind the existing building on 4845 South Street. And we will, as we normally do, we prepared kind of a hearing outline for these. Hopefully you've been given a copy. We just kind of drafted that, but we will follow that hearing outline along. If I can find my copy.
I'll keep to this agenda.
Okay.
My presentation is really good. So,
okay.
Good evening, Peter Bemis, Engineering Design Consultants. And I'm joined with, your name, sir?
Drew Carnes, CrossFit Resilience. We plan to be the occupant of the building.
Right. This is a existing facility where we are constructing a freestanding building for one specific user. So to just outline, this is the property, South Street. Here on the left side of the plan. For the most part, South Street is running the building south. We've got an abutting building here to our south as well. To our north, another abutting building, and 25 would be to our east boundary. So, we've got an existing parking lot that comes from the front side of the building, extending up to almost its terminus at 495. right-of-way, with loading across the back portion of the site on the north side of the building. There is a connection between these buildings. There's actually a walking path. These buildings at one point were developed by the same party. And the buildings are no longer owned by the same party. There's a building in between. The owners that we're here for, Weston Group and Front Point Management, own the next building, which the proponent, who's going to be the tenant in the building, is a tenant within that building. We would like to keep this tenant within the group, and we wanted to be sited in this area, and we have vacant land on our property. So we've got a 7-acre parcel. A portion of this land here does support a septic system for this existing site. We would abandon that septic system and tie into the municipal sewer. The sewer has been stubbed out to this property. We do have a water main that comes in and feeds this building. This is a sprinkled building, about 60,000 square feet. Again, with its primary parking in the front and moving in the rear. And under zoning for total coverages for this site, there's enough open land to support this proposal. We also did do some soil testing on the site, which is noted on this existing conditions plan in this area, to support our stormwater management system. For layout and our proposal, we've got our proposed building located in this position here. Our primary front will mirror the front of this existing building at 45 South Street. We're setting it up to be a multi-tenant building. Right now it's a single tenant that's going to occupy the building. In the event for future use, we're just recognizing that it'd be nice to be able to lease to smaller tenants in the event that the building is reused in the future. So we're setting it up that way. We've got parking across the front. We've got our handicap parking spaces located in this position on the southeast corner. Loading on the north side, and then it's the other building. We've got stairs to access that upper level. And a parking field being proposed there for the current tenants' occupation of the building. In the future, if we had a user group here that had a primary need for loading, these spaces would be eliminated. There's more parking proposed than would be needed for a typical warehouse or R&D type use of this facility. Also on this plan is a lighting photometric that's up in the upper left. Where we show where the light fixtures are located and then the resulting foot candles for those fixtures, table for the lighting. In the right corner is a landscaping layout. Again, we've got a number of different trees. We've got some flowering pears and spruce and different ground covers that are being proposed. We're trying to go with a landscape that doesn't have a lot of lawn area, requiring irrigation and whatnot, and everybody's gone through a drought this past year, so this is really a drought-tolerant landscape that we're proposing here, and that landscaping list is located on the right-hand side of the front. And the lower right is the zoning table, so as I outlined to you, we're proposing that there's no changes, obviously, with frontage and area for this lot, and then we identify our building coverages and our max height for the building, and then our zoning setbacks from each of the side and rear yards, which are all within your zoning provisions. And then the parking is 75 parking spaces with 3 handicap accessible. The third sheet in the set is the grading and drainage plan. So what we're doing for stormwater management, and we had some comments from the peer review engineer, so I'm going to outline what I presented, and then I can tell you where we're going with the project to address peer review. So we proposed that we would collect our stormwater in 2 locations, basically here at the rear, the loading dock being in a low spot, and then coming across the front of the parking lot, we had a catch basin here, and then here as well. And then we're taking all of that water, we're treating it prior to discharge within an infiltrated drainage system that's located on site. So we're trying to take all of our stormwater and put it back into the ground where it was already going under the pre-existing condition with this open land area here. We did stormwater management calculations that were part of a packet that we gave you. We also did a SWEP, which we also provided you with a copy of the SWEP, because we will be offering more than an acre of land at this site. I'll be happy to answer any specific questions to those. But in the stormwater calculations, we addressed DEP stormwater management guidelines, addressed each of the storm events. And in the SWEP, we're following the format for a federal by-right permit for construction on a new building site. The other piece on this plan is the drain to the sewer. So what we're showing for sewer is that currently the septic system is located here with a septic tank and pump chamber. The pump chamber then brings effluent up to this leaching area that I had shown you on the previous plan. That obviously gets all eliminated. Our new building comes out with a gravity sewer to this position, and then we run that gravity sewer back down and tie it into the stub out that was provided as part of the South Street improvements a number of years ago. We haven't applied for a DPW sewer connection permit yet. We need your site plan approval to go down there and say, here we are, we'd like to apply for that. I know the Board of Health made a comment relative to that, but we have to abandon our septic system as well. The fourth sheet of the set is the details. So upper right is the detail for the trench drain and the loading dock area. Contact different units for our stormwater treatment prior to discharge into our infiltration system, lower left. This is the Cultec inspection ports to bring back up the surface grade. Typical trend section for the work that's going to be done in the connection to the sewer line, and then our precast sewer manager. The fifth sheet is set, typical socket details, asphalt pavement, integral curb, walls, granite curbing, slope granite curbing, handicap parking, handicap ramps, soil stabilization, sedimentation, erosion control procedure. The sixth sheet is the SWEP plan. So it has all of the maintenance provisions on there and the construction control provisions. Again, the SWEP is like 40 pages, so it details how you're going to do all of this in specific detail, but this is really the plan outline for that. And again, the same requisite details. We do have a construction imprint that will be put in. We're going to remove in that portion of the parking lot. At some point, we want to control the movement of soil from that construction area. The other sheets I provided with the set were the architecturals. The floor plan was the A1 plan. And in the A1 plan, you can see what's being outlined for the user. It's a training room, registration area. We've got some offices, men's, women's room. They are proposing a kitchen. Again, the Board of Health made a comment relative to that. We realize that we'll have to apply to them for anything that would be a food service area. The building, similar to what's there. Basically, you're looking at the rear elevation here at the top, A2. It shows the three loading docks. This is the side view, and then the other side view and the front view. So it's a block building. It's anticipating the ability to serve other tenants. These punch-out windows could then become a doorway. You've got a doorway centered in the building because we're anticipating just the one tenant at this point. You can allow me to just jump forward now. We did get a peer review letter. So is it okay to segue into that? Would you rather go through comments?
Well, why don't we go through the detail and we'll hit it at each of that point.
So thank you for the opportunity to present that.
Okay. Are there any questions of the board on the overview? As board members know, you have plenty of time to speak and ask other questions. But go ahead, Cliff.
Thank you. The grade back there is only, like, it's minimal amount of grade elevation, from what I see here. 120 rising up to 123.5. So the existing septic system that is there, you're gonna pull that out and fill it. Is that what you're going to?
We're
do?
Gonna yeah. What we would do is that area would be excavated and removed and properly disposed of. Any of the materials are in the leaching area itself. Beyond that area, though, we are proposing a cut through much of that area. There'll be a fill within a portion of that area as well.
Okay. So in my map reading assumptions, the grade slopes away from the top. You know, like it pitches towards 495.
Yeah, portion of the site does pitch to 495. A portion of the site does go from north to south.
Right.
And a portion does go from south to north, if you will. I'll just kind of go through it. So this portion of the site is kind of shedding this way to the north.
Okay.
This area is shedding to 495 to the east.
Yep.
For the most part, this is shedding to the south, and there's a small portion that's shedding to the west.
Okay.
Into our own parking lot here.
All right. So to that, I ask, and I'm going to diverge here off just a bit. You spoke about more than one tenant at this point.
Not at all. I just wanted you to understand why. If I was a board member, I'd say, well,
you have one tenant that's going into the building and you're showing one entrance on the site plan, but we have the ability to do three, and I want you to be aware of that. I have three sets of stairs in the back, and I just think it's incumbent upon me to explain why did we do this. We did this for multi-tenant purposes. I hope that this tenant is here for the next 100 years. Hopefully his heirs will want to continue to do CrossFit.
Yeah.
But this is a building and constructed for the single tenant. It just has the ability to support a future tenant.
Gotcha. All right, thank you.
Related question. So I understand septic converted to sewer. Is that for the old building and the new building?
Oh, yes, sir. Oh, okay. I should have said that. I apologize. Yeah, that's all eliminated. It is 100% we convert to sewer. With your approval. I don't want to explain why we didn't go to DPW yet. It's premature. Without your approval, I have nothing to go there.
We don't have a problem if you start the process with DPW.
Then fine. I just didn't want to be presumptuous with the board.
No, that's fine.
Chair?
Yeah, go ahead.
Along the same lines about the sewer, is that a choice that you want to make, or is that something you have to do?
Well, we would have to do that, yeah. There's no way we could continue to have a septic system here and do all of the other things that we want to do. Without that provision being made. And I do believe the betterments that were required for this facility have been paid. Yeah. They just continue to use the sewer. They just weren't paying a tipping fee. But the betterments were paid.
Through the chair?
Yeah.
To that end, does this constitute a betterment for that building?
No.
No?
Basically, that sewer infrastructure in the street was funded by betterments.
Okay.
And they've been, like he said, they paid them just like anyone else. And whether you connect to it or not, you're paying for what's in front. So they have a right to connect to the sewer.
As many buildings as necessary?
I think so. I know they have a right to do it. Whether or not there might be some additional fees, I don't know that, and that'd be up to DPW.
I don't see our flows being extraordinary, but to your point, I don't want to answer yes, because I don't know the answer to your question.
Right, but I'm just bringing that up.
It's not our concern, and quite frankly, the sewer system was brought to that area to encourage expansion such as this up to, they have the right, I believe, under zoning to go to four stories at that particular location.
That's right.
Yeah.
So, I mean, yes, we are trying to encourage expansion in that area.
Absolutely.
So that's the reason why sewer was there. Jennifer, let's move on to the second item on the agenda, or outline. Hey, sir, you've got...
I do have it now. Yes,
okay.
Thank you.
We try to keep it...
This is good. I'll be prepared next time, because I'll say to Jen, give me that outline. I used to come here a lot back in the day. Kobe knows that. So we used to spend many a Monday night here.
Well, we're trying to be a little more organized now, but...
So last Wednesday, we held a staff meeting to discuss the project with representatives from police, fire, building, conservation, board of health, and myself and Elaine. DPW was not able to make it. So we reviewed the plans as a group and just talked about some issues collectively that we might have. And so in my memo, I've outlined seven of them. And for the applicant's benefit, I'll note that fire department had some concerns about making sure that they had safe access around the building, so they had asked that you provide an E110 flow path analysis. And they also said that they would probably like to locate a hydrant at the rear of the property near the new building. An independent review for fire protection will be required when you come for a building permit. The building department noted that the handicap signs as proposed on the plans do not comply with the town bylaw, so those will need to be addressed.
Excuse me, Jerry, are you going to give him something that sounds like he's
trying
to keep
up
with
you? I'll give it to you.
I'm going fast.
The second one in, the memo right there, it's on the second page, I believe.
Thanks, Jim.
They wanted to know how the sewer will be addressed for the existing building, which you just talked about. Lighting was a concern. They felt like there was a lot of lighting for what is the proposed use, and wanted to make sure that it should just be adequate for public safety and not excessive. And I would note that during the design review board discussion, we talked about the light. Some of the light does spill onto abutting properties, which is a violation of our bylaw, so that we would need to have that addressed as well. And then the existing pavement may need to be upgraded for access purposes as well, because there was, they noted that was some of it was a little choppy. And then I would just note that I didn't see on the plans any dumpster or any mechanical equipment, and so I would...
We knew about the dumpster. The rooftop units is probably what we'll have servicing the building. So.
Right, so they would have to be screened if they're visible from ground level.
And then if not, we'll show an alternate location, so I'll make sure that those are addressed.
Well, other than that, like I said, DPW wasn't able to make it, so I don't know if they had any additional comments. They didn't provide anything in writing. But other than that, everybody seems okay with the general use and proposal.
Okay.
Question.
Mr. Chair.
Oh, go ahead.
About the lights, the property that is owned by EDC is to the south of there?
They own another building to the north of this site.
Okay.
This site to the south.
The blue one is EDC, right?
Isn't it to the south? Isn't it the steel company?
Jergen
Steel?
It's Magnuson, but I'm not sure what the name is. So that's what's here. There is a vacant building in between. From what I understand, it's fitted out for specific uses.
That's a different
uses.
Owner, though.
Different owner.
Oh, okay. That's
totally
what
different owner. Yeah, well, they own the next one.
Okay. The one that would be the corner.
Exactly. That is basically the point.
I
kind
of didn't understand how that.
Okay.
Mr. Chairman, one question. We might go into lighting a little bit more detail, but I'm just curious, the hours of operation for CrossFit?
Sure.
For the day? Just
it's we open at 5 a.m. on weekdays.
Okay.
And close, our last class is 7:30. So we're usually out of there by 8 p.m.
And staff gets there, let's say, 4:30 in the morning?
So, say that.
The staff?
Staff will arrive at about 4:40. Yeah.
Okay. Just.
So we'll look at the lighting again. I know the commentary, this was an engineer's approach to lighting. There may have been a better way. I brought this up to Walter, who actually did the design.
Yeah.
And I said to him, we might have been able to do a different type of fixture that had a little bit more cutoff available to it. So typically, his view was, I'm against other industrial buildings in 495, but you still should try to go zero at the line. And I agree with that. So it's...
I'm sure we'll talk about it more, but
exactly.
I knew this
we'll
was not a 9-to-5 type of operation.
Yep.
They need extended hours, that's right, especially
sure.
This time of year.
Okay, I think we're down to two. We're on three on the outline already, which is the kind of beta's overview. And by the way, before you even get started, we encourage you to spend as much time talking with Phil or other members of the beta in between the meetings and solving it. And when they send us the letter that they're happy with the stormwater, we are extremely happy at that point.
Right. We're taking that approach, so I'm good with that. And we've gone through other projects with beta, so we understand that. Unfortunately, I was away last week. I was fortunate to be at Yosemite. So I can put that on my bucket list and say I've accomplished it.
Your priorities were in the right
place. Yes. I had someone else do the design review. But we will get back to Phil and his group with a proposal.
Okay, Phil?
It is, really.
First, I just want to take a moment to thank the board. This is the first time I met with you since you reselected Beta. And we appreciate your confidence in us, and we want to live up to that expectation, and we're always open to input as to how we can do a better job for you. So, first of all, thank you again for choosing Beta. The second thing is that generally we find the projects in pretty good shape. There's a number of issues that have already been raised about the access and water supply and stuff like that. There's just some paperwork items in terms of whether or not there's going to be signage or just cleaning up handicap accessible spaces and making sure it complies with ADA standards. We did note that the existing guardrail was in poor condition along with some of the pavement areas should be looked at just for safety reasons. We had a number of landscaping issues that could be looked at. Particularly as it relates to some sewer work going through the woods there at South Street. The Yeah, and we encourage the fire department to be satisfied with the access, et cetera, water service. We did note that there was no provisions for solid waste on site. The lighting did spill over, and we probably want another line to show on the adjacent property. It goes down to zeros. Mm-hmm. For the light spillage, make sure that it does not just stop it at the, yeah, the numbers at the line. Sanitary service, sewer service, and maybe some notes in terms of how that's going to happen chronologically. Obviously, you're going to have to build the sewer
first.
Service for everything. And then stormwater management-wise, there's a number of issues, and we can work through these offline, but one of the big things is the infiltration rate, your assumptions, and making sure that they, you're not using one infiltration rate for the infiltration rate and then for the hydrology.
I made the same comment when I looked at it closer. I said, we're having our cake and eating it too here. How can you do that?
and then just making sure that you can use the whole capacity for your infiltration system, because your elevations seem that once you get up to a certain elevation, it's going to start spilling over into your parking lot.
I took a whole other approach to it, the way I thought it should be done. So we'll get that back. I'll explain it to you briefly.
So I think that was generally it.
Okay. Any questions of Phil from the board?
Yes, I do. Good to
go
see
ahead.
You, Phil. I haven't seen you in a while since. The handicap parking paint on the parking spot and the sign would be kind of sufficient. I mean, it's a belt and suspenders, but that's the right idea. It's, they can just add signs to their plan, or they have to change their plan.
It's worse than that, because I had a look at it first thing. I don't mean to interrupt, Phil, but it's... They moved the handicap parking spaces from where they were supposed to be.
The people who made your plans?
No. What was there, existing. The existing condition building. Our proposal is fine. The existing building, what they did is, where the handicap aisle would be, they put two parking spaces on either side of it, moved the handicap space to the right of it.
You said they had them, if you...
Okay, well, so was I when I looked at it closer. The paint's very faded, but if you go out there and look at it, basically you should have an aisle for the handicapped pedestrian to go out of their vehicle, get into their wheelchair, and then go through. What they've done is taken the aisle and they put parking spaces for people to park in on either side, move the handicapped space to the right of that. So in other words, there's no aisle. You just have a handicapped parking space with a handicapped symbol on the painted on the ground,
right.
And you have no aisle for the handicapped pedestrian to travel through. So we have spaces that don't even come close to complying. So
but
it's
your plan that you showed...
We'll fix it.
was...
It's yeah, to
let
me...
Let me ask my question to Phil, because that's through the chair.
Yep,
right.
Go
so
ahead.
The plan that they presented now, which looked like there was wide enough handicap area, just from looking at it, if they just add signs, is that all they have to do, or is it...
Right. For their particular building... But we noted, when we did our field walk, we noted that the handicap spaces for the
existing building
did not
okay.
comply.
It
and,
wasn't
and
our
so, right. So it really,
wasn't
handicap
design,
spaces
it was
require
okay.
not only painting on the ground, but once you pull your car over it, you should be able to tell if it's a handicap by what
right.
the sign is. So.
For our benefit, can you just point out where the
handicap is? Yeah, sure, I'll do it. So each one of these is the aisle that you would have put aside for the handicap space to be on one side of it. But what they did, they're obviously having a parking issue at some point with maybe their tenants or whatnot, they took that and moved it over to the next space to the right. So instead of having the handicap symbol, again painted on the ground, being there, they moved it over this space. And the rationale is they probably needed signage as well, because there aren't signs in front of all of them, there are signs in front of some of them. And they put the sign, where they did have a sign, they put it here. So it's in front of a space, but it doesn't have the aisle.
Okay, so just so I'm
so clear. It's existing building, non-compliant.
Just so I'm clear, so you're going to make some fixes to the existing building.
We will
building
have a proposal
for handicapping
okay. yes,
and for sewage.
Yes.
Any other improvements?
Existing
to the building?
Well, I might encourage that we'll look at the dumpster location, because
okay.
one of them's just sitting at the left corner of the building
okay.
there.
Sure.
And
okay.
I know that if I was the fire chief and I went out there and looked at it, it'd be the first thing I'd comment on is that, you know, that dumpster can fall out of position, you go beyond the edge of the garden, now it becomes an obstacle for me. Okay. So we'll do a few tidy items for the existing.
What I'd like to do, it's 8 o'clock, I'd like to kind of have our discussion with the other folks on the agenda, but I would like to come back to this tonight so that we can make sure we have the outline there and then briefly go through a lot of these. I know we've got a lot of updates to the plan, so I'm not expecting to close a lot of them out, but I'd like to get through the outline portion tonight for at least another half an hour to 45 minutes. I'm hoping that we can reconvene about 8:30-ish. So at this point, I guess and you'll be you could.
I'll wait.
You wait. That's what I'm asking.
You put on the accelerator.
We will do it as kind of quickly as can. I'll entertain a motion that we continue the public hearing at the conclusion of our discussions on Auciello Road and other couple of discussions with Elaine Lazarus.
So moved.
Moved. Do I hear a second?
Second.
Anyone? Any further discussion? Seeing none, how do you vote?
Aye.
Aye.
All those opposed? All those abstain? Motion carried. Okay. You're welcome to sit in for the other discussion or stay here, whatever. We'll kind of go through it.
Don't go far away.
Yeah.
You can sit here at the table.
Yeah.
Okay.
Okay, we're going to shift gears a little bit and kind of talk about not that old a street. It's really kind of new street for me. But we've kind of run around it. So why don't you guys introduce yourselves and who's the spokesperson for the crowd?
Do ladies first?
Sure.
No, you can start.
All right, my name is Rob Little, and my wife and my two sons and I moved to town about 2.5 years ago. So we're here to ask some questions and see if we can.
Okay.
Your address, sorry?
I'm sorry, 6 Auciello.
Okay.
That would help, wouldn't it?
Yeah, just wanted to make sure you were.
I just live here in town. You want to guess where I'm at?
I'm Jack Mills. I'm at 5 Auciello. So we actually were the first ones in on Auciello Drive. Oh, 7, I mean. That's right. 5 is Mike.
It's only been 20.
It's only been 25 years, whatever, you know.
And I'm Judy Mills. 7 Auciello.
These are the hardest questions.
We can get through this part.
Okay. From what I understand, and this board has talked about it a couple of times, basically the street is currently in a position where it needs some repair. It's a private way, and I suspect that did town plow it last year?
Yes.
So they're plowing it as long as it's in reasonable repair, I think, at this point. And I know, let's see, who wants to explain the history?
Okay. So the plan was approved in early 1992, and it was built shortly thereafter. And it had been approved right when I first came here, and I wrote the decision that had already been made, and I'm pretty sure that the board included a condition that it remain a private way because the board really wanted a through road. At the time, the town didn't want a lot of dead-end streets, and so they wanted the through road. So the plan does show a through road, but the developer really wanted just the 5 or 6 lots on a cul-de-sac. So as a condition of approval, I think the board said, all right, you can have the cul-de-sac, but it's going to be a private way. The town isn't going to maintain it because the town didn't want dead-end streets at the time. And I think it was kind of a family subdivision at the time, and it was thought that most of the lots would be family. The developer, Michael Auciello, still lives there, as does one child?
Two.
One. Okay. Well, one lives with him.
Okay.
And
then his daughter's the first house.
So there is still a family presence there. But ever since, I don't know, for the last 10 or 15 years or so, this has been a chronic problem where the town has always plowed Auciello Drive. But in the last several years, the town has wanted to stop plowing private ways. And so over the years, the DPW was in touch with Mr. Auciello asking him to do the plowing. They never did. The town kept plowing.
Occasionally, the highway department would identify some minor repairs, and Mr. Auciello would make those minor repairs. But the board's been talking with the developer for a number of years, I think since 2009 or maybe even before that, about it becoming a public way, and kind of going back and forth. And as you know, in the last couple of years, we've had this program to get those old streets to become public so that the town isn't doing all of the maintenance. And I think we would have included this one had it not been for that one condition, and that the planning board's condition was that it remain a private way. That all of the other streets we've accepted, and the ones that are going to be coming up at the next town meeting, weren't encumbered by that condition. So that's why this outlier is there. It's in the same circumstances as those other streets that we've accepted. I don't think it's necessarily any worse condition, although John Whistling dropped off a couple of photographs today, and I did see there is a catch basin there that does need to be repaired. But I don't see that it's that much worse condition than some of the other ones we've accepted in the last couple of years. So I think we're here to talk about whether there's a path to acceptance, which is what we've been talking about, I think, since 2009 here. And board has gone back to Mr. Auciello. Nothing's really happened. I don't know that he really has the wherewithal now to do anything at this point. He is older, and not sure that there's much he can do. We have funds in our budget this year to do street acceptance survey plans for these old streets, so we can have a plan done. I did bring, we did have an as-built back in 1998, so we do know that it was constructed in accordance with the standards at the time that the board established. But it has deteriorated, like all of the older streets. So I think we're looking for a path to acceptance, and I think, you know, the residents can explain why that's important to them, but we want to get to some place where either it's accepted or someone is maintaining it. Right now, no one's maintaining it, and I don't think anyone's likely to maintain it.
That's not a good situation.
Question for Elaine.
Go ahead.
You describe it as a cul-de-sac, but it looks more like a dead end to me.
Same thing.
A circle? Well, I consider a cul-de-sac with a circle.
It's a circle.
It has a circle.
It has a circle.
Yeah.
Okay, it just didn't show it on the map.
Yeah, it's in the shade.
Okay,
yeah,
thank you.
It has a circle.
Thank you.
Yeah.
Google Maps didn't show it like that. Thanks.
Ken?
Yeah.
Is there a cost associated to maintaining that street at present?
Right now, nobody's maintaining it, but sure, if the town was to go in and, say, do some paving, I don't know whether the town would fix the catch basin, but there's definitely a cost to that.
So, as a private, and I'm new to the board, so please excuse me, as a private way, it was supposed to be properly maintained through the residential aspect of that, right? Not through the town.
Right.
And we've been incurring a cost of plowing and doing everything else on top of that at taxpayers' expense, right?
Right.
Okay. So now the road is in disrepair and needs to be done. Who would that onus fall on?
Well, I think that's part of what is being discussed tonight. And also, you know, I'll take maybe the other side a little bit. They're paying the same property tax rate as you are and I am. And most of our streets are getting maintained as part of that deal, as well as getting garbage picked up, which I'm sure the town does, and things like that. So it's kind of like we get into this discussion on private versus public ways about every time, 10 to 15 years after we grant somebody a special favor. Usually it's a family subdivision. We're going to do something kind of nice to kind of help them out. Well, after half the family is gone and whatever, and things start to fall apart, which is 10 to 15 years,
right,
then we kind of get into this portion here. And I'm only kind of bringing that up as kind of education for the newer board members because, you know, as we carry through and our nice folks, at the end, somebody else pays for it, type of thing. And, you know, we've done some that are better, like the one that we approved on Ash Street. It's a common driveway. There's an easement. They both know that they have to resolve that, or they're not going to get in and out of their houses. So that's pretty well set. But this, you know, if you drive down the street, you don't know that this is a public versus a private street. It looks like any other cul-de-sac we have in town, except for it's got a few more potholes, I think, than many over the last winter or so. So, you know, there's two ways. I think Elaine said, well, there's before people recommend things at town meeting, there's a report by the DPW director that says that it's in the right condition for us to accept it. And, you know, the developer would bring it up to speed and usually clean out the catch basins and a few other things. And then second of all, there's got to be a plan for street acceptance. You heard Elaine saying that we've got a little bit of money that we could probably, as a town, do the street acceptance. I don't know whether the DPW folks are willing to do the maintenance aspect on the pavement. And it's a question, you know, that isn't stuff that we can kind of suggest. But if we got it to the point where the road was, well, first of all, it's a philosophical question. Do we want to reverse the planning board decision of 1992, public versus private? And we will determine that before you leave tonight to make sure that. I'm not so sure that there's a big, the reasons that I, in looking through the minutes, and you all got copies of it, I didn't, you know, first of all, the minutes are not as clear as they were way back as they are today, because we keep much better minutes than they did before Lane, and we had professional work on this. What I could kind of tell is they really didn't like the fact that it was a cul-de-sac back then, and that seemed to be the way they kind of pushed it in there. That's what the minutes kind of say, as opposed to some of the other reasons why ones are. A lot of times a private way will become a private way because the planning board will make it less than subdivision standards in the construction at the time. And, you know, it'll be narrower, or it won't be paved, or, you know, it's a lot worse shape. At least this is of the standards that, you know, if it had been properly maintained since 92, we'd have no question of all, you know, taken care of it.
For context, for the new members and the neighbors that may not be aware, Mr. Auciello has come before most of the members of this board, I think last year, very nice man, and we have had more recent discussions, and I think two of the issues, as far as the DPW is concerned, were the street maintenance, which they're happy to do if the street's maintained, so the cost of the maintenance of the street, to answer Cliff's question, and then outside of just this catch basin here, there are major time issues and budget issues for DPW handling all the catch basins that are in town already. So it's sure, it's just one street and one catch basin, but it's on top of everything else. So it's not like the DPW isn't listening, but they are, you know, there is concern to answer Cliff's question. And then I don't know exactly where we left. I don't remember exactly where we left off with Mr. Auciello, but there were.
Well, he had brought a couple of issues in when he was last here, if I remember correctly. One was the vacant lot that's got the water detention pond. He says, well, I'd like to develop that lot. And we kind of said, well, if you get an engineer that says we don't need it, because back then it was needed, then, yeah, if you can show another way to engineer it, we don't care, you know, and that would might have prevented some funds if he was so inclined. We didn't hear much back, and then I think we kind of said the same thing on the maintenance of the street. It's just, you know, it's got to stop crumbling one way or the other. And yeah,
just a real quick question. I think one of the town goals recently is to get rid of private streets, right? If we can convert them over to public streets.
Well, we had back in that day, and this is a lot of the ones we did, there was the planning board didn't accept a lot of streets back in the early 90s, because they felt that if we didn't accept it, then we wouldn't be responsible for them. Well,
like you said, they're still paying the same tax dollars as everybody else.
Yes,
so.
Yeah. You know, to me, it's a fairness issue.
In my opinion, I feel that's a reasonable goal, and the DPW has to allow on their budget to be able to maintain those streets.
Well, before we get into a conversation about that, we can we should probably hear what they have to say, because...
Okay, well, I have some other thoughts, too.
Right, but that's more of if I may, through the
chair,
that's more of a functional part of the discussion.
Sure. Yep.
After.
Okay.
So just a quick note, and I know we're trying to make this a smaller thing than a bigger thing, but I just wanted to discuss the bigger thing, because I am kind of a fan of mm-hmm. the old school of less dead ends, less cul-de-sacs, and I just wanted to throw out there to see what the perception was amongst... Just a real quick question.
Okay, let's answer that one real quick. Right now, we have this exceptional circumstances rule on cul-de-sacs, and unless there's an exceptional circumstance, most of which is a large gift of land that goes with it, we have said no. This one probably under current standard would have said no, though I think the board said yes because it had the potential to connect somehow off to Laura Street or something.
Segueing to when I'm making a bigger thing. What is the thought process of connecting to Hillcrest?
Well, I think at this point that's come and gone.
Well, I just wanted to hear from these guys. I mean, how do you think that would affect the...
How would you connect to Hillcrest?
It looks like, according to Google Maps, it's a very short connection to the corner. You know how it comes around the square in the back there?
Yeah.
I mean, is that what the original...
There's a paper road there, I know.
But it must go more towards...
But in many ways, I think that's not something we're interested in doing at all, and nobody else is interested in doing that.
No, I know, because there's lots of issues with that, right? One is money, and who owns the property.
If I may?
Yeah.
We just made some sort of proclamation about trying to get rid of paper roads. Now, if we're trying to get rid of paper roads, and there's a paper road existing there, then why wouldn't we want to utilize that paper road to make it a go-through?
Well, because it's got to connect to somebody else that probably owns the property that's on the other side of that line.
But is the, but if
and, the and if they don't want to do it, then they don't want to do it.
Yeah, but if the paper road is existing and it doesn't, like, I know that there's a paper road between... The old high street, and between the mm-hmm. the Dunkin' Donuts, excuse me.
I'm just gonna make a point. Let's not digress. What's the point? We don't need to.
Well, I'm trying to get to the point, so please allow me to do that. Okay. And what I'm saying is that we want to get rid of paper roads. We have a cul-de-sac, which, as Ken clearly stated, that under today's standards, we probably wouldn't have allowed it. We have the paper road that is there. Why couldn't we do a pass-through and make it a complete road mm-hmm. under that circumstances instead of giving up the paper road?
Well, because we don't know what it connects to, and I think it's somebody else's private
property.
Well,
shouldn't that be looked at first?
No, no. What we're talking about is a much simpler solution. How are we going to maintain this road in the future? That's what we're really up for.
I mean, I made the point, and I do agree with Mr. Kistner. I think the quick and easy thing would be to just say, okay, let's see things as they are, and let's start maintaining it. But it should be a quid pro quo kind of deal.
Right.
We should do the due diligence.
Well, but no, the problem is that these people don't have the piece of property that you're asking.
No, but we have the paper road, Ken.
We have a paper road that goes to nowhere.
Right, maybe we can defer to Lane.
And I don't think the town has an interest in building this road. I don't think, you know...
And I think that's an issue.
...would want to fund the construction of that road.
And I agree with David, is that I think that's an issue that should be looked at through the town, through the highway department and everything else first, in order for us to see whether or not there is an implication that maybe we do want to do that.
Well, regardless of whether you accept the street to the cul-de-sac or beyond... It doesn't matter. It's going to be there.
It still needs to be maintained and brought up to speed for it to be maintained.
But only the constructed portion. Beyond that is the paper street.
I understand that. But we're going to be doing the work on the road to fix it.
Well, I don't know that. Well, perhaps. But you know, if you see a path forward to changing your original decision, so that we can move forward. I think I'd work with the DPW to try to get Mr. Auciello to fix the couple of things there that need to be done before winter, fix that catch basin. I think it's very important, and perhaps do some other work. I mean, we'd continue to work with him, But in a parallel, course, we would work toward acceptance as well.
So, you could accept peer review, the full thing? Without some sort of review on it, from us outside of our jurisdiction as the planning board, without anybody else's, we're going to just say, okay, we're just going to say, go ahead and do that?
Well, basically, if the question is we have a cul-de-sac with six residences on it, and, you know, this goes off and maybe makes more land. Who owns the land off to that side? Do you guys know?
Yes, there's a house there. I'm sorry, I can't understand.
So this would be our lot here. This is Rowe over here.
Is this the paper road we're talking about? And I don't. Where's Hillcrest?
Well, I can show you on Google Maps.
Yeah, on that side,
it's some distance away. Yeah.
Well, if you look at Google Maps, it doesn't really look like that distance at all.
Yeah, it's just that it's. So there's our house would be there.
I can
so you'd
see
have to
where
go
you
through.
Think it would
cut right through.
So, Mr. to the chair.
Yeah.
I don't want to deny these guys the opportunity to have.
And nor do I.
No, don't. Well, yeah, like I think maybe I can speak for everybody that we're. You know, frankly, saying the same thing.
Thank you.
What I'd like is, let's take a quick look at a true solution and just see if it's possible and see how much it would cost. And if that doesn't work, let's go to plan B, what we're discussing now, which is basically to turn the rover
and
over
that's
the
my
road
point.
As is.
Can so somebody pull up GIS on this, Jennifer, maybe, and see who owns that land for that?
Yeah, I mean, I understand the logistics might not allow it. It might cost too much to do it, and it might not have the land to do it, but can we at least take a quick look at it?
I guess I'm asking what problem is solved by constructing an additional road to help.
I think in this town, what I see is a lot of dead ends, and I'd like us to, you know, not have walls basically, but have connected neighborhoods to connect to each other.
Right.
And one neighborhood can talk to a neighborhood. And there's not going to be any kind of traffic coming through here other than maybe three or four homeowners going to Hillcrest. Mm-hmm. It's not like we're putting a cut through that's going to be a lot of traffic.
I'm curious, David, what's the end game?
The end game is once we go into the construction of that street, right?
Yeah.
How can you see
do it all at once and
but
make.
But the point is, you're either going to repair a small section or you're going to cut a road.
No, we're not repairing
the road. And next year,
if I were coming from Hayward, though,
it's a town road.
Why would I go all the way
up
to Hillcrest and I could just cut down Auciello?
That's what I mean. Just make small houses. It's small money.
No, it's just money.
It's not like we're hoping you up to this road for a cut.
Time out.
You're right. I thought there was more protection to the case.
Yes, there's not.
To the chairman, please.
For his neighborhood.
So I'll explain what it is. They're looking at.
Yeah, so it goes to someone's backyard.
Yeah,
well,
like
the paper road. Can I sit and take a look at it? Where is the paper road now?
It's ring.
So probably since then, someone's built the house.
This is Auciello.
Yeah.
Since then, no, because that's
the
current
cul-de-sac is like right here somewhere. Right.
So there's a short distance to make
Laurel
Ave.
But the town may not even have.
But we don't know that. But we don't know that.
Laurel Ave was always a lake, but on paper. It's on. It's a real road. And paper, real road, paper.
To Laurel.
Because it's so steep.
Oh, I see.
Oh, I thought
so.
Okay.
So it is
Laurel.
Yeah.
It's
sorry, well,
Laura, I believe.
It's so
Laurel.
Yeah,
right.
And so for that to be opened up.
It says Laurel on the GIS.
This is it right here. And there's no obstructions, no nothing. And to David's point is that why don't we have a connecting...
connecting road?
Yeah. Why would we do this and only fix a solution for now and then worry about that in another time?
Well, you can accept the full length of this road. However, I mean, it does go through their lots,
it's on a street. It doesn't go through anyone's lots.
Yes.
If it's
she's saying it doesn't go all the way to Laurel.
You know, you'd be building a house.
There's a short distance between Laurel and Auciello, and for us to open that up, there's a double cost here. To go out and do it twice is ridiculous.
I understand what you're saying, but. There's a house. There's a house. I'm telling you right now. There, the end of Auciello, our lot is here. Rob's lot is here. There's a house there, and there's a house right there.
I don't. It's just hard for me to.
I understand what you're saying.
So if there is a house, it's
there
not
really
sure
isn't
Google
though, sir.
Right.
I see it.
Huh?
There really isn't though. If you look right here.
Yeah.
This is a GPS right now.
Okay.
Okay. There is no house between
Laurel and...
Oh, is that Laurel there, the little,
yes.
The right angle?
Right.
Oh, all right, all right.
Okay?
Okay.
So there's nothing in between there.
But I think we'd have to look, talk to the two homeowners on the corner of Laurel and Hillcrest and say, would you be opposed?
Right.
But I mean, it's just a question.
Yeah, that's it.
We can't.
But,
I mean, if they
but,
say
but,
no,
it's part of the homework.
But why would the town want to make...
Connect communities. The same reason that we're trying to get rid of cul-de-sacs and paper roads.
I think it's the same thought process that the original board had back when they approved it.
Right.
You
like
can, I mean, you, your street acceptance can go all the way to the end. But, you know, short of an article at the town meeting to fund the construction, the design and construction of that, I mean, you're going to have to do stormwater and design. It was never designed.
Right.
There may be some grade in there. Short of that, it's not going to be built. Certainly the original developer is not going to build that.
No, but the town...
Do you think the taxpayers would want to build that?
But here's the thing, though.
Mr. Chair?
Yeah.
The town as a practice does not like to accept...
It has nothing to do with the
accept. Cul-de-sacs
are
dead-end roads, correct?
Why does that
correct?
Matter if we accept the road as a
right.
public road? Why does it matter if we want to build through or not?
Through the chair.
I think we're getting far from where we really should be.
We can make an approval on something that we don't take. We have one eye open on, or we can open both eyes and look at it. Right?
Well, I guess what I'm saying is I'm going to keep one eye shut, I guess, is because it's, you know, I don't see the value of spending $100,000 of the taxpayers' money to go through the loop.
Nor do I. But
well then.
But to look at the situation and have it said that it's going to cost that much money,
well,
then yes, it's worth taking a look at.
Well, it's you know, $400 feet of road is costing close to $500,000 these days.
Well,
if you're building it from new.
There's open land on both sides.
Doesn't matter, they're open. I'm just, you know.
My only point is, well, not my only point, but one point that I didn't mention was that you could build a couple, three more houses there.
Yes.
So instead, we might approve somewhere else a completely open area, a wooded area now and
unless
take that
it's somebody's
away.
Property, you can't.
Right. But that's what we don't know.
I'm not sure what you're saying.
On the other side of the road you want to construct, on the other side, on the sides of those roads, if that's somebody's property, you can't. You can't build houses.
No, but those people can. I'm not looking at it for self-interest. I'm looking at it for the town interest of the town.
If I may enter the chair, then it's a private road.
If I may enter the chair, please.
So actually, she raised an interesting point that Laurel may be a private way.
I'm not sure. That's a very tiny road.
It's
now
very
I know
it.
Yeah, I don't.
Well,
and
Laurel
don't
doesn't go all the way down to the lake
because
really
you
know that's where the steep part
right.
is.
I believe it's paved, but you're right.
It's paved. It's one car width.
Yeah, now
right,
no.
But
so
I think
you're not talking about hooking up with Hillcrest. You're talking about hooking with.
Well, no. I think when we say Laurel, it's that I can't tell
it's
by Google Maps that
it's
one section that is paved that is well maintained. It's a quarter.
Okay.
Of the square,
but it would be Laurel. It is
Laurel.
I don't know the name.
So I'll back out of what I'm trying to say, except I wanted to bring it to point, and it's on point now, and you can all make your own decision on it. I look at it like it should be looked at, and it should be duly noted. And other than that, if you guys all want to take a vote on Frank, go ahead. I digress.
Just for clarification, Laurel Avenue is a private way as well.
So we have the same issue.
So
right.
Same issue.
Yeah.
So why don't we clean up the whole area?
Well, the question is, how wide is it? If it's a narrow road, now we've got to pay to widen it because you just made it a two-way by connecting through.
But you can accept it without widening
yes.
it. We're just plowing it, and we're plowing
a pipe.
We're
plowing it anyway.
That's what I'm saying.
We're plowing Laurel, too, and we put
right.
sewer
yeah.
on it. And
correct.
But we made it very narrow in that area.
Right.
I mean,
so
it's
if we connect through, does that cause a problem with the
I don't mean
road
to sound obtuse to what you're trying to do. All I'm trying to do is look out for the future.
Sure.
And connecting residences, residential areas, that's what we want in town. We don't want all this segregation and then this open land that is not really not even yeah. So what we need to do is just take a finer look at maybe an opportunity here, instead of it being just serving a small group, we look at the bigger picture and look at it for the betterment of everybody in that area.
Okay, let's try go Frank.
As,
and then
as a suggestion
bring
to the chair, I'd like to hear what the neighbors have to say, and next,
okay.
And then we can discuss the different scenarios that we could
vote on.
Well. look at. We might need more information, which I think we do. But I'd like to hear what they had to say first, because they've come here. They're not used to us talking and debating, and I, you know, they probably have some very interesting things to say that will bring light to the situation.
And to the point, just to support that, and I believe Mr. Kistner feels the same way, is we're looking at one option, but at the very least, we want to help you with the simple option. Which
absolutely.
Is,
sure.
So
absolutely.
I think you understand where we're coming from, but
okay.
To the point, Frank.
Did you have much... What do you want to add to the
well,
discussion?
Well, my ask is very simple, right? I know executing on it from your end might not be that simple, hence the debate.
Yes.
But I'm a loving father of two small boys, so safety is my top priority, right? One could argue, is one of the drains just dipping down a little bit going to put lives at risk? Maybe, maybe not. but my concern is, heaven forbid something happens to one of my boys or my wife. We want to make sure that vehicles are able to come in and out with no issues, and that's year-round, right? If there's snow, I mean, even in the middle of summer, right? We don't know if there are certain areas of the street that could collapse, I mean, or sinkholes. We don't know.
Right.
But I don't have a lot of trust or faith in the structural integrity of the road right now, and that kind of creates a little bit of anxiety for me. Again, as a father, my job is to protect my family. So, again, priority is top concern for me. And on a more softer note, I mean, we want to be... We want to have a lot of pride in our streets, so I think that there's something to be said for aesthetic, right?
Mm-hmm.
As you know, people maybe moving in and moving out of the neighborhood, there's something to be said for curb appeal.
Absolutely,
I think so.
To that point, quick question from the chair: are there sidewalks in the neighborhood, or
there are sidewalks? Okay. Yeah, there's one. So it's just looking a little ratty, right?
Sometimes but sometimes the look, it goes deeper than just the look, and there's an issue. And this is where I find I'm bringing up a pertinent subject, is that if we're going to restructure that road for safety purpose,
mm-hmm.
just say that alone, then we're already incurring an expense that... Let's look outside that scope just a little bit further,
mm-hmm.
get a good view of what we're doing and what we're allowing, and if it can be curtailed that we can save money doing something better all at once, great.
Right.
And then your safety issue is met. Our safety, our overseeing of the planning board's stature is being looked at,
mm-hmm.
and then we all come back and we say, okay, this works and this doesn't work.
All right. Go ahead, Judy.
Just, you know, I understand your point of view and I respect it. And I think it's one thing to look at Google Maps and it's another thing to live there and walk the property. And I think we have to balance what's practical versus what can be done. Is it, as a taxpayer, I can't really understand the value of putting money into building a new road to connect. I think if you saw it, you'd see what I was saying. It's two very small roads. I understand the point of community and all that, and I'm certainly not against that. It wouldn't make a difference to me. I just, as a taxpayer, I just don't think it's practical.
And I agree with you, through the chair. I agree with you. And I say to you this, is that all we're doing is asking for someone else besides this board to take a look.
Okay.
Let's
figure out.
Please?
No.
Just one quick comment.
We got to bring this to conclusion. We can't talk about it all night. I think you're in a majority on trying to build a road.
I'm in a minority?
I'm trying to build a road.
I'm not trying to build a road.
The planning board is not constructors of roads.
We're not.
We're planning for the town.
Yes, we're planning for the town.
It's part of the bigger picture.
Yes.
So Mr. Chair, just a quick note, because you threw in the expense of putting catch bases and everything in. We just saw a development of Legacy Farms that uses low-impact development, which is a lot cheaper, so I wouldn't want to overlook something like that.
All that would go. I happen to know an awful lot about that,
right.
particularly. I put the sewers on Laurel Avenue through the whole thing, and I built what little bit of pavement is there.
Sure.
But the only philosophical question you got is the Hillcrest Drive area and this one a little bit safer because you have an two ins and two outs. That's philosophically the only really difference you got. Now, Hillcrest has been there like it is forever.
I disagree because there's other reasons where we're trying to build a sidewalk network that connects neighborhoods too. So this you can't just throw out stuff like
you
that.
You can put the sidewalk on Hillcrest and you know you can walk the loop and you could make it a walking path if you wanted to connect.
Is that all hypothetical, Ken?
Yes, it is.
Okay, so
because I would love to see you champion as a citizen petition to try to get a couple hundred thousand dollars to go build that road.
I'm not advocating that. I'm saying that someone else on the side of our board.
Yes, you are.
You're talking about having the town explore building the road through. You don't even know if they want it. It clearly doesn't sound like one of
I am not.
Want. Why do we want to kind of build something there that they don't necessarily want? They just want to fix the street that they're on.
I understand that, but that's at a cost to the town anyway.
No, it's right. Not. We're talking about where the cost is.
I'm not denying that's not going to cost the money town, but I don't think we should do short-term solutions
right.
Just because it's going to cost some money to do it the right way.
Right. Right.
So, yes, you do have to go fight that battle in front of the town and get the money for that. But we shouldn't say no just because we don't want to fight for it.
Right.
Yeah. I agree with Ken through the chair that the bigger picture is philosophically having two ways in, two ways out for that entire neighborhood. That's a question. And then everything else is kind of a side question of that. And the specific question we're here to talk about is Auciello Drive. We're here to hear what they have to say about it.
And I would bet the conversation in 92 went like this. Mr. Auciello said, I'm trying to build six lots for my family, and my God, that's going to cost me X hundreds of thousand dollars. And if you want to double the length of the road and make me connect over to Laurel Avenue, my poor family won't be able to afford to build this road. That's what I guarantee the discussion was back then. And you know,
okay.
The planning board in 92 made that decision back then, kind of.
Just to be clear, it's about a third more from looking at Google.
Okay, it's a third more. But, you know.
I agree with the point.
And there was also some point in there about topo type, you
sure.
know, whether the hills are there and
yep,
whatever.
Sure.
So, you know, so basically that's what 92 said. And they said, well, it would be nice, and we don't like these cul-de-sacs, but we're living with it. And that's when the planning board kind of made the philosophical decision that Cliff is talking about way back with. Now, we have the horses out of the barn on a private road that needs maintenance. And I think Elaine has offered to have the town do the plan that's needed to accept it if we were willing to go to a public versus private road. And then there's the real question of who brings it up to a standards that the town at town meeting would say we should accept it to. And that's a question that we can't answer tonight because we need the DPW folks to weigh in on that. And we also need maybe the neighborhood to look back as, are you guys going to bring it up to the spot, the condition where they can get plowed in another month and a half?
It's coming fast.
Yep. And you know, how do you make at least the set of repairs that make it so that it can continue to get plowed, or the town could say plow it yourselves, and I don't want that to happen either.
None of us do.
And the town.
To your point, I think we should focus and approve what we have in front of us best we can. But I think in the back of our minds, we should think about, in a later discussion amongst maybe perhaps just the planning board members, about what we want to do about trying to connect neighborhoods. And, huh?
It's an open meeting.
No, but so I mean, not trying to blow the people's time. You know what I mean?
Yeah. So, Mr. Chair,
yeah.
Back in February, we released $4,000 in funds back to Mr. Auciello.
Right.
Had we not released that, we would clearly have the money to do the repairs that are needed.
I understand.
That's my case in point.
Now, I mean, and we made the motion, we seconded it, and we approved the release of those funds. You know, I mean, he built it as a private road. You know, clearly it sounds like he's not going to do what he needs to maintain it. There's no association. We are stuck.
Suggestions?
I wish I had some. You know, I wish we had that $4,000 still. It would be a no-brainer.
The residents, when you bought your property, you were told it was a private way?
No.
You were not told?
I was not told. I was not told that. Two and a half years ago, when we moved in. But you would think that something would be disclosed, you know?
Right, I think legally.
Your deed shows
that we have the right of way to go. So we were the first ones in '95.
Be prepared.
And on the deed, so the deed, you can see right here, it says that, do they have the right to use the streets as shown on said plan with others lawfully entitled thereto? The purpose of streets, ways are commonly used, the town of Hopkinton. So we knew it was a private road,
okay.
But Mike Auciello was the developer, so it was his road. Because Ken's right, when he did this original plan, the idea was he didn't want to have any people on the lots. It was just his family.
Right.
About half of them bailed out. They weren't coming out from Newton, so we were the first ones to buy the first lot, and then he sold off the other lots to pay off the road. Mm-hmm. So we never had any, none of us had any intention. Rob's the third one in that house, and every owner that's been there, that's the same thing.
But he's the same thing you got, right?
Yeah. I mean, it's the same.
So he knew, he had to know that it was a private road.
Yes, but it doesn't state any maintenance requirements around that. It's all through the developer,
right.
Who's Mike Auciello and still owns it.
Again, through the chair, I don't mean to put up this proverbial wall for you guys,
mm-hmm.
Okay? I want to work with you, and I think that's in our intention of the board. And as you can see, nine people on this board there's a mixture of opinions here. And this is what we all have right now, is that's why we're such a good board, I think, is that we work together for a resolution in the best betterment of the town.
Let me
finish that up, I think the point was that when everyone bought the houses, no one was instructed at all that they had to either have an association, whatever. The plan was that, yes, it was private, but it was RCL's responsibility because he was the developer. So we all looked at it as it's his road.
He'll take care of it.
He'll take care of it. And he told us all he'd take care of it.
How's that working for you? No, I'm just
kidding. I can go back to 92 and fill that paperwork out, too. Excuse me? Yes. Technically.
To Jack's point, we were under the impression, too, that he would take care of all this stuff. Or at least that's what I was told, you know, during the process, because I don't think the realtor wanted to position it any other way, because that may have swayed our decision to buy the house.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
And he won't be there forever.
Yeah. Right. I mean, he's elderly.
To your point.
He can't do it.
Winter's coming. Yeah.
I think you got two short-term things. One is there's got to be some kind of repair so that the plow will come in and everything is cool. And the easiest way for that is for you guys, six on the lot, to figure out how to get it done. Or talk to Mike and say, hey, it's legally, it's kind of your deal. And whether you got to kick in some part of that, I don't know.
Well, Mr. Chair, you've been talking to the DPW, right, to see if they have some kind of funds to...
Well, technically, they're not supposed to use town money on private land. That's part of the deal. So
$4,000 was given him to do what? Apologize for interrupting.
Well,
I just like to better understand.
No, it was held off to the side.
We held the bond, and then he kind of made the point, well, you know, we've been holding for 20-something years, and we released it.
And he had made some recent repairs.
Things were looking better than they do currently when you go out there.
And I don't want to impose a cost to you guys, because you are taxpayers, and just like everybody else.
There's also a fairness. It is a private road, and to get to a public road, we take basically pristine roads when we accept them. And, you know, the normal developer, you know, fills all the cracks and cleans all the manholes and gets rid of all the debris that's in the detention pond and all that good stuff, and then the town says, we'll take it. And then he stops paying taxes on it.
The analogy is a private septic tank versus a sewer.
No, the
private septic tank, you're responsible for.
Well, there is no sewer.
No, just an analogy.
Oh, okay, so, I see what you're saying, yeah.
So bottom line is, we got this short-term thing, and we don't have, planning board doesn't have a bucket of money. You know, there's nothing that this group can, unfortunately, do. I think between the residents, you've got to figure out a way to get it to a point where DPW isn't going to cut you off in the short term. Now let's go to the philosophical question. if it was up to a reasonable condition next spring, would we accept, I'll say, the roadway either all the way through or the roadway with just the bulb? We could accept the land, the paper street all the way up there that would allow one to connect to. So let's just say we accept this plan, which shows the bulb and the little piece up there. If we didn't accept that other little piece, half would go to one person and half would go to the other person, usually. That might take, no, it wouldn't take town meeting because we haven't accepted it. Yeah.
I wouldn't feel comfortable with approving that street unless I knew what happened, the history with the paper trail, why it was cut off.
Right.
What do you mean why it was cut off?
It doesn't go all the way to Laurel. Obviously, somebody
made I think it does. If you look at the GIS, it does.
Well, on paper, but they only designed up to this.
No, but I thought Jennifer and...
No,
the
Well, it's not constructed.
I thought you said it was over people's property, though.
I said people may assume it's their property.
Okay.
Yeah.
Okay. Thank you. Okay.
Yeah, I'm sure the people that are on that part of Hillcrest both have their garden and their trailer and everything that's throughout Laurel Avenue.
I actually know the woman who lives on the corner. I should ask her.
Okay. So anyway, the second real question is, Would the board philosophically look towards recommending this to go and changing our decision of 92-ish to go from public to private? And I guess tonight let's just talk about it philosophically, because I don't think we have to vote on it tonight, and we might need a hearing on that. I'm not sure. That is kind of a big deal. But let's just talk philosophically tonight. If the road was up to fair standards, I'm not saying pristine standards, fair standards, such that the town would, you know, could accept it, and Elaine ends up having the town paved to do the acceptance plan, which is a survey, which would cost us several thousands of dollars probably. Well, hopefully less than that, but it depends on whether he has markers and all that good stuff that were put in the ground, and you can find them all.
At least there's a plan to work off of.
There's a plan to work off of, which helps. So if it was that way, would this board philosophically have no problem accepting the street as a public way versus a private way? And why don't you just start with you, Frank, and then walk down the line.
Thank you. Like Brian, I'm concerned with the money we released.
Can't do anything about that, though, right?
True. But in light of the whole history, from looking at the meeting notes from 1991, and in light of the current needs, I'd be open if we got the entire road and explored connecting the neighborhoods. That's my position, because we gain something as a town, as opposed to fixing someone else's mistake. I think the town would be better for having a connected neighborhood.
Okay.
Totally agree with what Frank said, and the only thing I'm kind of dealing with myself is, realistically, as a town, these guys have actually gotten free plowing, free road maintenance.
You're paying taxes.
Nope.
It's your turn.
Nope, it's a private road. I mean, that's part of the deal. We can plow them for free, and they should be responsible somehow in completing the road as it was originally thought it should all the way through. I'm having a problem with that, you know, internally myself.
I don't think you should say we've benefited. Mr. Auciello has benefited.
No, you live on that street.
But again, that's why I asked you.
Okay. He's never turned the street over to the town.
Let's just say the town.
But here's the underlying. Is that's why I asked you about your deed.
Mm-hmm.
It shows clearly that it's that it's private road. Clearly.
Well, it doesn't say it's private. Well, it says we have access to it.
Well, you have
it says I have the right to use the road as all purposes streets in the town of Hopkinton.
Yeah.
All it says.
Yeah.
I'm all set with what I said. Thank you.
Okay.
So philosophically, I'm not comfortable in overturning this board's decision from 1992. I could be persuade, like Frank and Dave said, if we could find some kind of a connection. You know, as a town, we don't like to accept cul-de-sacs or dead-end roads. So to connect it, you know, now we're talking about accepting a road that actually goes somewhere as opposed to goes to nowhere. And that's about the only way that I could find myself accepting this.
Yeah.
Assuming all the repairs are made, I would support the decision to make this a public way. Without the extension to Laurel Ave.
Ken, was that part of your assumption that repairs would be made?
Part of that.
You said hypothetically,
okay.
Yes.
Yeah. Okay.
Yeah. Okay. Matt, would you be opposed to taking that land to have it there so that, you know, it could connect at some future time if you want?
Yeah, I mean, I'm okay with that. I think at this point it's unrealistic to, determine if we can connect that to Laurel Ave. I think it's, it's not in their best interest, and I don't think it's in the best interest of the people on Laurel Ave.
One, two, three, feet, I think, if that, and then whatever has got to go on Laurel Ave. We're talking about probably $300,000.
Low impact development?
Even low impact development.
Mm-hmm. I'm in Brian's camp on this. I'm not in favor of overturning the board decision from 1992 unless there is some extenuating or exceptional circumstance, which I don't currently see at the time. I'm really wrestling with whether or not to kind of look to develop it out. I don't get the sense that the residents on the current street really are interested in having it developed out. So just to be able to do that, to say now that's the exception and make it a public versus a private road, I'm not sure that's in the best interest, but I am open to exploring it. But in the current state, I'm not in favor of overturning the previous board decision.
And to David and Frank's and everybody else's statements, I feel that it needs some more exploration, and that to overturn this now would be like a dropping of the ball on our part. And I would choose not to do that at this particular time.
That's it.
I think from my point of view, I can feel for the homeowners. It seems like they bought into a property and they were either led to believe or never told it was a private way, which to me constitutes some type of legal action against whoever actually owns the road. If the town were to get it fixed so that it's usable, I could see acceptance. As far as the cut-through goes, I don't know if that would benefit any of you. It probably would make your street a little less safe because it would increase traffic flow, which I'm sure you don't want. I don't know how much it would increase, and that's the problem. You never know.
There's no outlets out of Hillcrest.
Right.
Well, there may not be, but now you have another. Then what's the point of connecting? Oops, if there's no
there's a neighborhood,
but you can connect a neighborhood with a walking path or many other different avenues. You don't necessarily have to make it drive through. It's a neighborhood.
That's an option.
You could just be a connected path where you walk through it. Doesn't have to necessarily ride your bike.
Good point.
Which I think might make it more of a neighborhood, because now the kids will be able to play with other kids versus driving your car to the end of the street. I don't see that.
And rather giving the land away to somebody else.
Yeah, and I would be in favor of taking the land to prevent anyone from developing it.
Well, it's town-owned land, right?
Right.
No,
exactly.
No, it's not.
No, it's not. I don't think it is.
Paper roads aren't?
That's right.
No. Paper roads are not.
No. Okay.
So that would prevent any further development.
So to his point, he's got a good point.
So then, if the road were up to snuff, I would look into it. I think right now, Ken, you're absolutely right. There's nothing to vote on, because what are we voting on? It's not a legal road. It's a private way. And for us to accept something that we have to put money into makes no sense. I'm sure the DPW would be thankful to make it a public way, since they've already used their sand and their salt and their driving hours to maintain it. So in the long run, I think, we probably is in our best interest. But today, it doesn't sound like it.
Would it be helpful, through the chair, if you had our minutes from our meeting last year with Mr. Auciello, would it help your discussion with him as the owner of the street?
Because this one's struggling. How do we motivate Mr. Auciello, right? I know that he's a great guy and everything, but you know, some of us age gracefully, and he may not have the motivation to make decisions on behalf.
And speaking of motivation, I think we're open to work with Mr. Auciello and the neighbors, and we're here. I just think we all are kind of.
I'm sensing a consensus that we're expecting it to get up to a standard where at least the DPW feels comfortable running a plow by it.
And what is that, fixing this drain or
fixing the drain and maybe where the pavement is starting to really crumble, you know?
To Mr. Little's point.
They worry about the plow blade getting caught and hung up on it and, you know, wrecking the plow up and wrecking the road.
So we can refer Mr. Auciello to
maybe the DPW at this point?
We've already spoken.
Oh, they have. Oh,
today,
okay.
I think.
Oh, okay.
And what was the outcome?
I just want to make sure we're communicating accurately.
It did not go well.
This is the first I've heard of.
Mr. Chairman, here's the thing. Mr. Auciello's been here in 92, 2009. There's been opportunities here, but nothing ever really percolated. Is that correct? I think he had his cake and wanted to eat it too.
Good intentions, but he's not a developer.
There was a call that took place today.
And again, through the chair, I'm empathetic with what you're faced with. I really am, and I would be doing the same thing you're doing, and you're doing it right. Let us find or let our chair figure it out. because he was so quick to say, let's just go ahead. Let him figure out a solution to this.
As I mentioned earlier, I think whether we try to obviously work with DPW and Mike Auciello to get it buttoned up, but
it didn't go well, as you said.
That's just one conversation. That doesn't mean it's the end. But if acceptance is not at the end of this, then what's the point?
Right.
Yeah, I think we have to
hold
up.
Here's the problem.
If you're never going to go for acceptance, what's the point?
I do want to make the point that I can't speak for you, Rob. I can speak for my husband, but I can't speak.
Why not?
I'm not against connecting the road. I don't want to give that impression. I mean, it's more the frugal Yankee in me saying, is it really worth the money? But philosophically, I'm not against it. I want you to understand.
But to your point, I would like to say this, is that we're not against accepting the road. In due diligence, the road repair get done, not being that substantial cost. Then you can come back and look at us and say, look, here's the road. And then we can all take a clearer look at that and say,
well, if it was today, then let's leave aside the argument of why it's laid out the way it is. If the road was in, I'm going to say, pristine condition, we would recommend it to town meeting for acceptance as a public way. I mean, if you know that, and with the engineering plan that shows the road acceptance, I mean, that's kind of where we would be. Now, we've got two things that are holding us back. One is the current condition, and the second is this board in 92, way before most of us were even thinking about this type of stuff, made a decision along with the developer that they would keep it a private road, and they would not force him to spend another 400 feet worth of road.
And the reason was because it didn't connect, right? So I agree with their philosophy.
They put it on paper so that it could connect. That's why that piece is there. So it could connect in the future, but at the time they decided that it wasn't worth the extra money to connect it through. And probably if it would have connected through, it would have been a real easy decision on their part too. But it would have probably cost him the equivalent of whatever $400,000 costs today.
I just had a question. This has been a learning process for me so far, but you know, one of the things I'm struggling to understand is what is the economic value of connecting those neighborhoods? If you were to boil it down to dollars and cents and how that benefits the town.
Does it have to be economic?
Does it have to be economic?
Well, as a business person, sure. I mean, we try to masquerade other...
You guys are out of luck.
Because here's the other thing.
Let's try to finish this, because we're already half an hour over.
So we can take my question off the table if it's standing in the way of progress.
The question is, why would we have that connected? Is right now, Hillcrest, there's only one way in, a tree falls on there, and then another tree falls on the person at the end of Hillcrest. Mm-hmm. They have no way of getting the rescue squad there.
So it's a safety issue.
Okay. Yeah. And the same could be said for your road, except for it was probably made a little bit wider at the time. There's not as many large trees yet, but in 20, 30, 40 years, they'll have grown up, and you know that's the way it is. So philosophically, we don't like dead ends. We don't approve any of them over 10 units, and we require exceptional circumstances. We have, since the years I've been on the board, we have approved several dead ends. Usually, we are given large chunks of land to help us make that decision.
That makes sense. I appreciate answering the question. I just wasn't sure when we were saying if it was economic or if it's safety.
You also mentioned from a financial point of view, your kids. Mm-hmm. And I think there's value in connecting neighborhoods between kids.
Me too.
Distinction there. So it's not just a financial gain, it's a community benefit as well.
Makes sense. Thank you.
Yeah.
And I have a question through the chair.
I'm sorry,
sorry that I take this stance this way, but I think if you guys were outside the scope of being living on that street, that maybe you would take that look at it the same way that I'm looking at it, and that's what I joined the board for, was to make decisions that are the betterment for everybody, not just the people that are involved.
Okay. Let's try to finish this up. Do you guys have, number one, like to make sure that at least five of the six property owners are interested in doing something with it? Maybe the most important one. You know, I mean, technically, unless he said yes, you know, legally we couldn't do anything on it anyway. I mean, you know, because he owns the road.
And so that's the problem too, because unless he says yes to us to do anything, he still controls the road. He doesn't want to give up control of that road.
Well, we don't know that, Jeff. I mean, he's more willing.
He does want it to be. I think in the past he said he wants it to be accepted. But I think he's come around.
Plus, you're
think
have
years
the option
ago. If he moves out, you can have a plan in place.
But unless the town takes ownership of it, it'll never connect through.
If I may, I believe, I don't have the minutes in front of me, they're fresh in my mind from last year. I thought the question was, should we release the money, stay in private road, or use the money to help pay for the road in the future? And he was happy to take the money
and do the repairs. The issue was...
That's exactly what I remember. Okay. If I'm wrong, this is from last year's meeting.
Basically, when we put up a bond, it is for certain things that are uncompleted on the road. And those were completed.
Stormwater.
Right, and whatever the whole process. And he completed all those things that the bond was for. And that's why we released the money. We do not set up or withhold or bond money for future maintenance items on private roads.
I think we had some part of the discussion was the road being public or private, and he was happy that to keep, he asked if it would go public. So he wouldn't have to pay taxes on it, then he was happy to keep it private for whatever.
And he also wanted to develop the retention pond.
Right.
And we said, if you can find a way to engineer out of it, we're willing to look at a plan.
And that's still in the other.
But,
it's still possible.
But, you know, it's really up to him and the neighborhood to get it to the point that, you know, it gets plowed this winter. And it's now the end of October. And the asphalt plants close about the 15th of December at the last. So, I mean, and, you know, snow can fly almost any day now. So.
So just to make sure that I heard, because this got bigger than I thought tonight.
It got bigger than I thought it was going to be, too.
Just so when we communicate to Mr. Auciello, I can make sure that I'm accurate. So if he brings the road up to reasonable repair, then as a board, you'll consider accepting it as a road, as a public way.
But the portion of the board...
Well, she said consider, so
consider.
Yeah.
Okay, is that fair? Okay.
I'm clear with that statement. Okay.
And the town will maintain plowing it.
If they, once it's,
unless you accept
it. DPW has to look at it.
So if the DPW accepts the repairs that he makes and they're comfortable with that,
yes,
they'll plow the road.
But even so, it's up to the DPW to do it as a favor.
Right.
Okay. No, we understand.
No. I just wanted to clarify that.
And we don't want you to be left out in the cold, so to speak.
We appreciate it.
And the only budget that we kind of partially control is we have a little bit of money that we can use to do those set of acceptance plans. And I guess we put that on the table tonight for you.
Okay.
So
that'd be greatly appreciated.
That saves a couple of grand, maybe.
But I don't want to have that plan done.
We won't do the plan unless he is willing to go, the steps to get it there. We got to start on that plan probably January time period or sometime to try to get it. We got to get it done before the May town meeting. But we would get it under contract, and as soon as the snow, then.
And not to exacerbate this any further, but you have legal rights as residents against Mr. Auciello.
Well, not much.
Well, I think we should wrap it up.
One question for the chair, for Elaine. Is Laurel Ave on a list of streets for acceptance?
No.
No, the old lake roads are not on the list. We're just doing old subdivision roads that predates subdivisions. So from the 20s.
Okay. I think we've spent more than a lot of time.
Right. Can we just summarize next steps, just from your perspective?
Come back after you've kind of talked with DPW and your neighborhood to figure out how you're going to get through the winter.
Okay. So I have one conversation with Mike to get him motivated to act, and I'm having another conversation with
John Westerling John will set the bar as to what really needs to be done.
So he'll let us know what the standards are.
Right.
And the town has communicated that to Mike,
so Mike will know that it's
okay.
John's already told him.
Well, thank you all for your time.
And one more thing, is they can get the minutes from last year, so that they can have the latest.
You would be able to read that through.
That's an action item. Can we?
Do we have a bunch of them here somewhere?
I have mine. I can give you mine. I mean,
Well, they're also online. They're on the website.
Here you go. Unless you want a hard copy.
Yeah, these jackets. You can get them online. That's fine.
This I think is a full set. You can have mine.
Thank you
very much. Appreciate everyone's time and consideration. Thanks very much.
Thank you.
We want the safety of your children, honestly.
Thank you.
And you know that, Mr. Little.
I do.
Okay.
I do.
Okay.
And we are here for feedback.
Okay, now we're going to reopen.
So feel free to send us feedback on progress or
questions.
Okay.
Keep talking.
Thanks again, everyone. Have a
keep talking
night.
To Elaine on this one.
The more you talk, the more you sound.
Elaine's here for feedback.
Elaine, one last thing. We Elaine did a Legacy Farms school piece. Excuse me. I just want to talk just a second.
Guys,
yes.
One conversation, and let's start going more through the chair, because I got to get a little bit better control here today. Elaine put a new piece. It was on your table. It's got a couple of interesting things in it. I had her calculate some of the ratios of kids to second and third bedrooms, fourth bedrooms. So from that, you can accurately, maybe if you assume that the north side equals the south side, you can now forecast where school kids are on Legacy Farms. And I can't remember what was our budget for school kids.
So it was 270 total, and then for the apartments, it was an average of 19 with a high of 22.
So that would be roughly 290-ish? 292 maybe at the max?
Yes.
Okay. If you take these ratios out, and this is kind of the first time we've kind of seen it and had enough data, and this is based on several hundreds of these homes done. If I take the ratio out, I'm projecting 366 kids.
So, yes, you did tell me that earlier, but then I thought about it, and Elaine and I talked, and does that mean you're saying that all of those kids are staying in the school system for the, because some of those kids will age out of the school system.
Because we didn't do it's not a forecast.
Well, the assumption I guess I'm making the assumption that the mix of school kids that's in the occupied places continues the same as what it might be in the future.
Although, just like in other neighborhoods, you know, the kids will age and the people will stay there, and so eventually the kids will be out of the system and the people will still.
That's true. And, you know, there could be some of that. There are also going to be a lot of 2 and 3 year olds that are currently in those houses that are going to join those ranks, too.
Right.
And, you know, so, I mean, there are a lot of kind of assumptions on that, but we could have maybe another 70 school kids more than what we might have been forecasting 10 years ago. We didn't see that trend, I think, the last couple times we looked at it. The apartment complex is a little bit, is kind of almost double of what we had been forecasting of up to 22 kids. We're at 44. That's down from a high of 52 at one point.
It seems to fluctuate quite a bit. And that's one thing Judy Barrett did say, that they will go up and down, especially in the apartments.
Yep.
I just want to caution that the math number isn't a forecast, a scientific forecast.
Right.
It's just an
arbitrary.
But it's
more than arbitrary.
It's based on a bunch of assumptions. And applying the same ratio, you know, you don't know. Is it the same demographic that's going to buy on the north side versus the south side? The north side has more two-bedroom places than three bedrooms, so that might change the ratio. There might be more kids in a three-bedroom house, you know, that's built into that ratio. We don't have the ability to know which kids are in a two-bedroom versus a three-bedroom. We just know where they are from that. The assumption that I had Elaine do was to take the master bedroom out of the equation and just figure kids on the secondary bedroom.
Right.
Second and third bedroom.
Yeah.
Mr. Chairman, question. Is there any value or is there enough data to be able to project out for 2017 and 2018 where we think we're going to be? Because if I was looking at this from a future perspective, I'm going to go, or, hey, I feel like, you know, the board and we've all kind of hit our run rate in terms of where we're at.
How long did they say it was going to take to build the north side?
7 to 10.
Oh, so that's more than...
They did, from your data, 60, 70 units on the south side per year since it started, so... You know, let's say that the north side continues at the same rate, and there's 425 to go there. So that's, 7 years?
Yeah.
6 years?
From now. The first unit maybe a year from now.
I think it'll be a lot quicker than that. But.
Sure, I have a question, and maybe it's here and I'm not seeing it, but what percent built is Legacy South?
It's almost done.
Mm-hmm. About 90.
It's 24,
about
85%. Maybe about 20 permits left to get.
Okay.
Well, if you
so this 109 number is probably close to being.
Because we did it based on the occupancy permits, so we're not counting ones that can't be occupied yet.
Right.
Right, but that's still an unknown.
There's building permits out there, but
there's 210 out of 260. No, it was 235, or what was the number on the...
I think that's right. I think it was
about
475.
25 more to sell, is that what you're thinking?
Well, it was 475. It's 275 on the south side. So it's two.
Oh, is that what you're asking?
Yeah, mm-hmm. It's 275. That included the 15 single-family houses, so it's 260 condos. And of those on the south side,
210
have been occupied out
right,
of two.
So you're looking at probably a ratio of 75%.
Well, yeah, that's what I'm trying to hear. The number 210 out of how much?
210 out of
275.
Well, 275 includes 15 single-family houses.
So 80%.
Right. And the bedrooms at the bottom, the remaining bedrooms are north and south. So basically,
there's some.
So she's got those included in there.
If we have 250 students on July 1, 2019,
mm-hmm.
there's no penalty paid.
I don't think Roy's going to pay a penalty based on the building out ratio at all. I can't remember whether there's another condition at the end.
There is another beyond that.
Yeah. The first one he's
that's
not...
That's the number we're working toward now.
The first one he's not going to hit. Anyway, I just thought while Elaine was here that, you know, we would talk quickly about that.
Yeah, Mr. Chairman, if I may, when is our next census?
They do that every year in the beginning of the year.
Oh, we do?
Mm-hmm.
So we should have these numbers, say, by
well,
January,
it might be an interesting to take the town census and look at the ages of the kids that are in each of the houses.
That can't be disclosed.
Can't
right.
be disclosed?
No.
Can the town do it as an aggregate?
I don't know how much data can be disclosed. We're not to know how many children in any given house, and probably even by street.
Okay.
Well, doesn't the census ask how many children under a certain age?
But it's kept confidential.
Or,
it's
registration.
Yeah.
Okay.
And the school committee can't help us.
No,
they won't.
No, it's confidential.
Right.
So this is reported.
Yeah, what's the purpose?
So this is reported because we have the host community agreement. But in normal circumstances, we wouldn't necessarily know.
Well,
so we have the host agreement so that we have that number.
Right, but we'll never know who's in what house.
Well, let's move on.
Okay, let's we got to keep moving along here because let's get back to reopening the public hearing. I did.
Thank you for staying.
For
sorry,
for,
it was so long.
45 South Street. Okay, we are at the point of the outline where we are adding to the outline. I see no
Do
members
we need to
of the
reopen
public.
Or no?
Yeah, I just did.
Okay.
I'm sorry. And right now we add to the outline. Frank, I'm going to take the chairman's parameter and I'll give you my additions to the outline. Under building design, I want to talk about HVAC units or HVAC unit screening. I think if they're, from what I gather, it's going to be on the north, on the top.
Yeah.
Parking lot design. I want to talk about the 10% landscape portion.
Yep.
Make sure that we do meet that. Fire truck turning, handicapped parking. For the lighting, I think we're really interested in the spill and overall levels. Okay, then I'd add to that number I would be signs, J would be dumpster. And that's all I've got to add to it. Are there other members of the board that want to add to the
solar panels?
Solar panels are on there.
I had dumpsters. You got mechanical equipment, which you talked about with HVAC. Sprinklers. Are we sprinkling this building?
I think it's required by the fire code.
Okay.
Yep.
I knew we talked about the old building or the other building being sprinkled. I didn't know if this one was.
Yeah, I know there's a fire service in the existing building, 60,000 square feet. Definitely.
Okay.
How many floors in the existing building?
One.
Other items you want on?
One, just a question for you. What's your name? I'm sorry.
Peter Beans.
Peter. if back to that original question that I asked you, the runoff towards the highway, right?
for stormwater and everything, that once you do your filtration, that flow, is that going to be a greater flow towards the highway?
No. We balanced our watersheds when we did our analysis.
Okay.
Okay.
Beta, do you agree with that?
Yep.
You do.
Okay.
Well, I mean,
it's still
they have to refine some calculations, but that's one of the requirements. They have to make sure that they don't increase the flow in any direction.
Okay. Are there other items we want to add to the outline? Okay.
Mr. Chairman, under lighting, we've got the lighting when it turns off, and should we also talk about
timing?
Yes.
Okay.
When it turns on, because that's again.
Got it.
Timing.
Timing for the lighting.
Okay.
Okay. What I propose that we do is kind of go through these really kind of quick on a summary level to make sure that you're walking away with all the action items, or at least we hope are all the action items, so that we're very productive next time around. And from a traffic standpoint, I saw no traffic study, maybe some data on number of customers that are expected, at least for this customer. Did I miss that somewhere in that? I know it's from down the road, but
I did discuss it, and that was my point, is that we're taking this existing use, that when they backfill that space, that they're not going to be using it with the same type of intensity. So really, that use is coming here. I think it's a better location for this use. It's further away from that lower intersection, which is really one of the primary reasons why they want to move out of where they are, too.
Mm-hmm.
So to me, it's
but it's your thought, right?
It's a flat.
That's your thought and not a study.
Yeah, I mean, I'd ask you not to burden the project with that added expense. If you would insist on a study, we'll do a study. I would think that you've analyzed South Street extensively over the years, and this use is not going to impact South Street. That I'd maintain professionally and personally. I drive South Street myself, but quite often.
A gym is not going to impact?
No, sir. That gym is already on the
street. Existing.
I'm moving that existing gym.
Oh, okay.
That's all I'm saying, sir. I'm just saying I'm taking a use that is at a more critical stage in the traffic flow. I'm moving it away from the critical stage. To me, I think that's a good movement, and I would rather those dollars that are needed for the study be used in other areas of the project.
I'm not so sure that we're looking to get a study. I think we're just kind of looking to
talk about it.
Understand the magnitude of the traffic, how many trips are in it, I'll say peak times, not to see where it is relative to what's out in the street, but just so that we have that information so that the next time we go around, we know what you've generated on the trips, so that, if the hotel goes in down the street, we can take all the data and kind of lay it on, just a maybe a one paragraph summary of what's going in and out.
So projected use.
Yeah, more on peak time. Projected.
Traffic.
I'm more interested in the use as opposed to,
Just for clarification for people viewing at home, you're moving the gym from a pre-existing place two driveways down, also on South Street, to a new building on South Street, and there'll be new company renting that new other space. So that there's not really additional traffic because of the gym. There's additional traffic going
for the new
to the overall.
Sure.
I don't.
Which is what South Street is for.
And to the case of that point, with my thing is that you get a new gym, a new facility. It opens eyes to want to go to that facility. That's going to increase a percentage of revenue and business. Because of it's new.
I would think that's the only reason why that gentleman would want to go there. Yes,
right,
yes,
right.
Yes.
So again, there's a spillover of more traffic.
It's relatively small compared to the whole street in ENC dumping out thousands of people at rush hour type thing.
That's my point, and that's why I have no problem doing the analysis that you're suggesting.
We're just looking for a little bit of information, and, and if it was an R&D use or even a warehouse use, it would be certainly a lot less folks going into 10,000 square feet. Okay, I'm just going to quickly go down it. Everyone kind of, if you think of other questions, let's try to get the questions out. The building design, the only real concern that I suspect that people have is the screening of HVAC units on the roof. And that's a standard that we've been holding. Probably the existing building probably doesn't meet that standard. I'm not sure. I can't remember, but that's something we've been.
This is not going to be highly visible from even from 495 because it's in the cut area of the highway section. But I, having the local requirement, we'll observe it and we'll.
No billboards allowed on the roof.
Yeah,
for 495.
Yeah, but the
actually, I believe they are.
What? But no,
they're
allowed.
They are.
I believe you are allowed, but from you can see them from 495, I believe, but
for that property, but not for others.
I know Putnam Pipe wasn't able to.
Okay.
Anyway. We'll comply with your sign provisions as
Well.
They said they weren't going to at design review, but
stormwater. If you should take that and make Mr. Paradise happy by the time, and he gives you a letter that has no action.
We had some time to discuss our new approach to this, and I'm confident
that's good because
the review is practically done.
Thanks, so
you had more time than you expected.
We had an hour.
Yep. Sorry.
So I don't have to ask about this contact system because that's what I was going to ask. I don't understand what size are you using?
The chambers?
They're detailed
on the plan, sir? On the detail sheet? It does say the size of the unit?
Oh, it does. Okay, I didn't see it on the sheet.
And then
I just
we use
was
that unit in a calculation that's a program called HydroCAD, which is an industry standard that.
And it's designed for the C&D soil that you use?
Yes,
that
it
you
is.
Have.
Yes, sir. Yeah. It will be.
That's
final
what
analysis.
I was going to ask.
Okay.
Yeah. Yeah. It's and that will be a you know, if you're still unhappy the next time around, ask the question again.
Hopefully it won't make
and
sense.
And it's also kind of, you know, get an opportunity to watch one of these going in when they're putting them, and you'll see what the expense is to deal with stormwater.
It's expensive.
Yeah, this is not cheap.
Since Benny's going to be our stormwater expert, don't you think he should attend one of those?
I think so.
I'll let you know when we're doing it.
Okay.
I've had the opportunity to see one go in. So.
Parking lot, we're looking for snow storage.
Quick question on the parking lot.
Is that two-way drive going around both sides of the existing building?
Oh, yeah, we maintain full access.
Okay.
I'll flip to that other page. This complete circulation. Here today with this intermediate road that we maintained and then around the back as well.
Mm-hmm. Quick question. So I saw 24 feet, is that from stripe to stripe? On the bottom. Yep.
Yes, 24 foot aisle.
So it's from stripe to stripe. And what is the width on that, in the roadway in between the buildings?
Right. That existing driveway, he doesn't have a mark on the plan. I believe it's on the order of 24 feet.
Okay.
Not more. I didn't see the need to widen it, but you know, if we had to, we could.
24 feet is fine. I just didn't know what it was.
I just don't want to render the site more.
We've had parking lots built that are really narrow, so.
Okay.
I think 24 feet is our standard.
Right.
Yeah.
It would match your standard. So for snow storage, you know, we do have a perimeter area which will accept snow. You know, with a site like this in general, I mean, there are points where the snow level gets so great that you have to export it off site. And that's why you have licensed snow dumps that accept it and charge an exorbitant amount of money for it. But that's what happens when you get to a certain point, you have to haul off site. We do have a stormwater management plan for the site because there are going to be some maintenance items, and that's one of them is for snow removal at a certain point, it has to be hauled away from the property.
Yeah, and we typically put a condition these days that requires
just that right?
Because
I agree.
You're right. If it's like two winters ago.
Yep.
The 10% landscaping, Phil, I don't know if you've done the calculation on this one, but
we'll make sure,
That's you know, tonight it's just action item.
Yeah, just letting you know we're it says we're 22.9, so
okay.
We'll verify that. It should be well over here.
Well, this is the landscaping within the parking area.
The internal areas of the parking lot has to be 10%.
Okay.
And let's
I'll go for it, Jamie.
And should, because this is an addition, I think, is it appropriate for the board just to focus on right around the new building for that requirement?
Because
the rest of it is existing,
pre-existing
aspect of it.
I would agree with that, Ken.
Mm-hmm.
Okay. Then the fire truck turning ratio, you know, just to make sure that they can get our trucks through there, the turning lanes. And then the handicap parking, we've already talked about it, but...
I have a question, Ken.
Go ahead.
The setbacks from boundaries, does that, in the setback through Beta, does that go from the parking lot a boundary, or does it go from corner of building to boundary?
Buildings.
There's both.
Okay, so I see a couple areas where there's a retaining erosion barrier, an erosion control barrier that they want to put up with a stone wall, and at the precipice of a point up top where the V is. Yes. That gets very, very close in that area. And then also on the far side towards you, the closest part of that parking area to the boundary there.
But do those? I don't think those walls count for a setback.
You don't have to have any setback for a wall.
No, but I'm just talking about setback from the parking lot itself to boundary.
Like the property line?
The property line.
That part's
but
not
the
changing.
Wall is not the parking.
No, I'm not. I mean, you're just using the wall as a reference to show you that point right there.
We do comply with the local setback, but I'll ensure that.
Because I looked it up here, and it shows 30 and, I believe,
yeah,
what
but,
was it?
But
40, 40 and 100.
Something like that.
Yeah, but,
well,
but
there's building setbacks, and you have to go to off-street parking.
Right.
So that when you have to, in the zoning, it typically, I mean...
I'm trying to find it right now.
It's further back than the original building, so it's...
I don't think the building setbacks are any problem at all,
no,
and I think the other, if anything, there's a landscape buffer requirement, but I'm not sure we have that in this district.
It is referred to in a handout as marked on 110, 168, I believe, section 168. I could be mistaken on the 168 aspect of it, but while I was here, I was looking it up.
Okay.
And there is...
Well, let's just leave that as an action item so we make sure that the buffers are set. But I
160 are minimum building setbacks.
Just minimum building setbacks, but then we had another one too that.
Well,
you have to go to the.
If you're looking at 210-168, that's in the Osmond. This is not in the Osmond.
No, but I'm talking about one of your handouts gave a reference to.
My handouts?
Yep. Gave a reference to what we should be looking at.
Okay.
In compliance.
Okay. So basically, we'll just add setbacks to.
The zoning setback is detailed on the plan. That's what the dashed line is
right
around the perimeter, so you can see the building is well outside of that.
Yep.
And then your local parking setback, we are also observing that requirement.
Is that like
zone.
A 10 feet or
yes,
something like that?
Well over it, but I'll put it on so you can see it.
So we can
know.
See it.
Yeah.
Okay,
that's fine.
Okay. And then, so I'm kind of running down there. Utilities, you've covered 90% of it. Frank will ask you some questions of why you're not putting solar panels on the roof, because that's his favorite topic. Almost.
I'm going to bring it up to the owner, because it was one of the action items that was on Jen's list. I mean, to do it up front is going to be more cost savings, and I believe one of the tenants is solar. So I would
select.
So I would think that he'd be able to make a deal with his own tenant.
Mr. Chair, quick question.
Yep.
But I mean, it's not a mandatory thing. So
it is not a mandatory.
I just want to say,
Peter,
you know,
quick but encouraged.
About the utilities, are they all underground? Going to be underground?
Yes.
Even the existing building? Or?
Yes.
Okay.
They're underground.
Thanks.
There is, I just remember the
utility pole.
Yeah, it's utility pole. I mean, there is some overhead here that comes from the other property. I'm just trying to make sure I get that view properly.
Well, we can just add that as an item. We don't need that.
There isn't.
Electricity is going underground to the new building?
Here. and then we were bringing it, actually, no, we're extending it overhead. He brings it up the existing overhead service that comes into this property, and we're extending the overhead.
There's one pole.
Yeah, so you've had a couple of new poles?
What
is our policy, Jen? Do you know on poles on existing industrial property? It's not a subdivision.
I don't off the top of my head. I'd have to look it up. I don't know.
I know the chairman of the board told me that no new poles are allowed in town.
Right. On subdivisions.
I'll work with staff on that item. I mean, is how we service. Yeah. Honestly, you folks could invoke some policy, and the power company is going to tell me how I'm going to service this building. I'll have to come back to you.
Yeah.
Because it's really going to be them dictating to us how they'll service our building.
Yeah, we fought that battle, and we usually win.
Do you? Okay, I'm glad, because usually we end up being subject to having to come back to you to say, the power company told us this.
And
all utilities shall be underground. That's
what
So I think we're looking at.
And I may ask you for a waiver. I'll try to seek out the power company between now and the next meeting. But if I don't get an answer, then I guess I'll take your.
If not, we would kind of say, go from that pole that's existing pole and go underground.
Yes, sir. I understand.
Okay. Construction management plan, we're not looking for a little bit, we're just looking for a little sequence. I don't think we need a detailed construction management plan, but we want to understand the sequence of sewer, septic system, construction, and...
And I think there was some issue with fire and police about how, when they do construction in the back, how that's going to impact the ongoing operation of the existing building, and patrons coming in and out, and employees coming in and out, and construction vehicles coming in and out, and that kind of thing.
Do we know how the back of the building is being used? Is it most of the employees going in the front?
It's a bunch of smaller doors.
What I see happening here is that the Solec folks have kind of occupied this ground space.
Yeah.
They use it as a transitioning zone for when they're bringing in panels and taking...
No, but I was just wondering if the construction vehicles could go out the back. And
sure, we could control traffic. Oh, absolutely. I would agree with that. Not a problem.
Yeah, there's a lot of material storage in the back
right now. Right now, that's what's happening.
Okay, and the last two items were signs, which we said you're going to talk about, the dumpster. We typically have a requirement for the dumpster to be screened. And we're pretty flexible how you want to screen it.
I think you're going to move it too, right?
Yeah.
Well, there's just an existing one. But this isn't visible from it? Is that screening doesn't constitute screening? You want it visible from the property itself? Okay,
yeah.
I just want to understand the terminology here. Very good.
Most of them put
we'll
up
just put
a gate on it,
Okay.
And what kind of fence you want to do? It's
a really strong gate, right? Is that what you said? Really strong gate.
Really, really strong gate.
This is from past projects, I hope. Okay.
I think that's kind of it. Before our next meeting, Jen will probably have conditions that we'll put together based on where we're at from it. Our next hearing is, available date is?
November 7th, if you can get everything done.
Yeah,
in two
I was
weeks.
Talking to Phil. That's what we were hoping, and we still want to try to get ground broken and get a foundation in before it's cold. Get it backfilled. So that's why the urgency for us is if we could be on the 7th. And it is asking a little bit of you folks, but no, everything
right
will be
now.
Here.
What?
We have nothing on that agenda right now.
So 7:30 on the 7th?
I'm not going to be here on the 7th. Okay. I'm going to be in New York. I mean, North Carolina.
Okay. Is a significant number of other folks not going to be here?
November 7th.
I'm here right now.
The day before the election.
November 7th.
As of right now.
Okay, November 7th, 7:30.
You won't
be
here.
Someone else will be
here.
Okay.
Well, hopefully I'll be set and you won't
be here. Just be here to smile at you.
Yeah, Ken,
can I add to the construction management plan?
Absolutely.
There's some type of written document about where that solar company is going to put their their equipment currently, that it's taking up parking space that obviously is going to be ruled out, and now you're going to limit what you have. So can we just have something in the plan that says this is where they're going to
sure.
put their stuff?
I'm sure they probably don't have the authority to put the stuff there. It's just been happening. So
okay.
I'll make sure that's clarified.
All right.
Okay. Is there other questions, comments, just to make sure that we've got a productive session the next time? And I think we made a lot of progress today, and I think we'll get things cleaned up. Hopefully,
from my end, I am going to pursue the sewer permit because
yep.
I want to get
sure.
the building permit quickly,
absolutely.
Foundation permit. So I am going to pursue the other items that
sure.
I know I need. Just
yeah.
want you to be aware.
This
that
this board
that.
Doesn't have any problem with you getting sewer and water for this building. Okay, so I entertain a motion to continue the public hearing to November 7th, 2016 at 7:30 p.m.
So moved.
Second.
Moved and seconded. Further discussion? Seeing none, how do you vote?
Aye.
Aye. Anyone opposed? Anyone abstain? Motion carries. Thank you very much.
Thank you.
We'll see you soon. Okay, let's try to get through the rest of this stuff here today. Okay, you will find in your package the Legacy Farms transfer of athletic parcels and municipal parcels.
Thanks, Phil.
There was an email from a town council over the week, the weekend, that they suggested up to three options of trying to resolve it. The issue is once the town receives the athletic parcel and the municipal parcel are part of Legacy, we kind of hold the restricted land covenant. And once we're the owner, you can't hold both the restriction and the land in fee. So I think all the legal guys have come up with option three is the only one that really works for Mr. McDowell. And you're seeing a recommendation from Roy that that's the one we proceed. And we have a motion, which the board has to find for two things for us to vote, which would then allow, I guess, a public trust or something to be set
yes.
up to.
They would have to create a public trust to hold the restriction.
Right. And who's going to be members of the public trust? I don't know.
That would be up to.
Mr. McDowell.
Or his company.
Okay.
The Legacy Farms LLC would be the ones establishing it.
Okay. So basically we're in partnership, only the partnership working the other way around.
Yeah. I mean, it'd be similar as like if SVT, Southern Valley Trustee, is going to hold a restricted land covenant, except they won't hold an athletic
right.
parcel. So this is just a another sort of trust land.
Right. And the municipal parcel, we can put anything the town meeting wants to put on it.
Correct.
And we can put very limited amounts of things on the athletic parcel,
mm-hmm.
including a marathon museum.
Mm-hmm.
And this would preserve all of that stuff and allow us to accept the land. So basically, the first thing the planning board has to do is to find that the change is minor in nature and no public hearing is required. And the rationale for that is we're still getting the land, like we said. The purposes are all the same. It's just now a administrative detail to make sure that it can work out. So I'd entertain a motion to find that this change is minor in nature and no public hearing is required.
So moved.
Second.
Moved and seconded. Further discussion? Seeing none, how
well,
do you
vote? Well, I have a discussion.
Oh. Okay.
I think it should be a public hearing on this, no matter what type of change this is, because it bears a little bit more scrutiny, in my opinion. And I would like to, I believe the reason that we're asking that the number one is being asked here is because this wasn't in our packets by, posted by Thursday.
No.
Okay, then why is this?
That's the recommendation of town council that it is minor in nature and does not need a public hearing.
And we do that on every administrative thing when we make amendments to site plans or special permits.
Okay, so meanwhile, the other half of my question is this in our meeting notice?
It is on there talking about Legacy Farms transfer of athletic and municipal parcels.
Sure. So that's why I'm confused, because I thought you guys were talking about the email from the weekend, not from the...
Well, this is the motion that implements the email from the weekend.
Right, and the email from the weekend was not in our meeting packets.
Correct, and I had put in your memo that Town Council was still working on writing all of that up, and that's why it was not ready until Friday. I was out at a conference on Thursday and Friday, but I know that Kobe had sent it off to you guys.
Yep.
And I had spoke with the chairman, and he and I felt that because Town Council had deemed it a minor change, that reviewing it over the weekend after the package was out wouldn't necessarily be a hardship.
So maybe I misunderstood. This what you just printed out is the same thing that got mailed to us?
That's correct.
Okay. Then I'm okay with that.
And I just want to point out on page 4, it does say, I just lost it. It is our opinion that holding these two parcels in trust for the public constitutes a minor amendment to the master plan special permit because the deed restriction meets the definition of the RLC under the bylaw.
Okay. So I think we're ready for a vote on whether it's minor and no public hearing is required. All those in favor of finding that, say aye.
Aye.
Aye. Anyone opposed?
Opposed.
Anyone abstaining? So motion carries. Okay, the second one is, let me read the motion. To move that the Planning Board amend the Master Plan Special Permit issued to Legacy Farms LLC on May 13, 2010 and subsequently amended on May 30, 2012, July 11, 2012, November 20, 2013, December 9, 2013, March 3, 2014, April 30, 2015, August 12, 2015, August 8, 2016, and October 11th, 2016, to allow restricted land covenants to deviate from the forms of restricted land covenants listed in Appendix B of the Master Plan Special Permit, provided that, one, the restricted land covenant complies with the requirements of the sections 210-164 and 210-170 of the zoning bylaw, and that the restricted land covenant is approved by Town Council. So that I would entertain this motion.
So moved. Second.
Moved and seconded. Further discussion.
Discussion, Mr. Chairman?
Yep, go ahead.
Who will actually control this parcel, the athletic parcel, once it passes through?
Technically, it will go to the Board of Selectmen because they control all land. Mm-hmm. And once town meeting would take that requirement, and they are controlled to the point where they are very limited by planning board action as to what can go on there. Right now it's athletic fields or potentially a
museum
or potentially an ice skating rink, I believe, is still available.
That's still on the, yeah.
I mean, and that's on the athletic parcel. The municipal parcel on Wilson Street is open-ended for any municipal use. I don't think anyone on the planning board would recommend it be a good school site for some obvious reasons. Mm-hmm. You know, it's not a good cemetery yeah. site because it's kind of rocky.
It's possible.
It's a very nice open space at this point, and probably for our future in town, maybe that might be the best use, but who knows what might come about in many, many years.
So the control is essentially under the auspice of the Board of Selectmen.
Yeah. Okay. And obviously for the athletic parcel, it'll probably be given to Parks
right.
and Rec to implement what has to be done.
Imagine.
Once the, you know.
Would that still constitute the museum then?
Museum gets more complicated.
Yeah.
I think it'd be... Part of that is athletic, even with the museum, and there was some talk about some land swaps and some other stuff potentially. But
the museum is still associated to athletic because it's the marathon, right? Would
correct.
That be would
correct?
That,
right.
Yeah, I don't think anyone's going to be too excited about transferring land over to, you know, the Collins Foundation to make a museum.
For the context of the newer members, we had the Marathon Building Committee give us a presentation on possibilities there, and then can refer to other land as further up in privately owned land that's possible in the future to swap to. So it's all.
And that other land has got a for sale sign on it right now.
Mr. Chair, I'm not sure the exact location. Is this on the south side of Main Street?
No, it's on the north side of Main Street, right when you first see. You know where the solar farm is that we approved?
No. Where it's intended to go?
That was after your time.
So down the hill on the left side of the valley there?
Yeah, right. Yeah. The gas pipeline goes across.
Where they're looking at putting the sidewalks in right now?
That's correct. Yeah. Exactly.
So it's like a farmland out there, right?
That's right.
Okay, thank you.
It's that first cleared area. Yeah.
Thank you.
Sure. And then the municipal land, and you can see it up on one of the legacy maps. After we're done, I'd be happy to show it.
Okay.
So, through the chair, I have a question for this discussion. I'm on two minds on this in regards to the 500 acres that they're trying to attain, and I don't have a clear memory that the gift to the town of the athletic parcel in particular was to be included in that land, and I don't... we're talking about 40 acres counting for that land, so I'm kind of confused about the timing of it historically, so I would like to get more information before I'm able to vote on this.
Okay. I'm pretty clear that's always been part of Roy's calculations from day one. I mean, otherwise you just don't get there. I mean, you know, he certainly wouldn't have given us this land. It was part of a negotiated deal at the time. Part of that negotiated deal was that with potentially 366 school-age children, maybe having an athletic facility on that area might be, and their parents might be a worthwhile thing. Mm-hmm. And that was part of the negotiations,
My question is, before I can vote, and I think before, I'm asking every other member here, before we can consider voting on this, if we can have in front of us in black and white, what the agreement is in the covenant as it's changed over time and everything, but I believe the original intention was that these were gifts of the town in order for these special... permit to be master plan to be accepted, and I'd like to see clearly that these lands were part of his calculations. And the last time we had discussed this, we were talking about what constitutes this mm-hmm. type of land. Is it between the houses? If it's too close, if it doesn't feel comfortable, you don't feel comfortable walking on it, can we accept that kind of land as a conservation restriction? And this is broader than that. This is outside of that. And I'm a little bit concerned that I would just like to see in black and white. So I've only been on the board now 3 years. It just happened before our time. I just like to see in black and white where it says that the athletic parcel in particular is part of the of the CR acreage.
Well, we set up an athletic parcel CR as part of the first special permit. So obviously that was part of the restricted land. And the 500 acres isn't open space, it is restricted land. The only difference really is that right now we found that we can't use that exact CR because we can't hold it and own the land at the same time. But basically, I would imagine probably most all the same words are going to be in there. If you look at the last time we did the tally sheet, which I believe Elaine did, there's 500 acres of restricted land, barely.
Thinking of the tally sheet.
And from that tally sheet, 500 acres included these two parcels.
Mm-hmm. Here's the
thank you for the host community agreement that refers to 500 acres and the athletic field parcel being included as part of that.
Excuse me for a minute.
So, Chair, is it okay if I write something down on the board to ask a question?
Yeah.
Yes.
Sure.
I was given these numbers. Is this rightable, this thing?
Yeah. I have no idea.
I was given these numbers, and I thought it was by boy or something, but the north build, as far as acreage, I had a 75, and the north open, I had a 38, and the south build, I had a 55, and the south open.
Yep.
I had 140. I mean, I'm just trying to figure out what the 500 acres.
Those numbers are kind of way off. I don't know where those.
It doesn't look right.
That might have been one thing that we voted at the last time we voted and changed the boundaries a little bit around. But all the open space adds up to 500 and like 1 acre or something like that. It's really close. And Elaine has a budget of where it all comes from.
Okay, so you should see her?
Yeah.
Okay, thanks.
There's a big spreadsheet on it.
To the chair, for the record, our master planner has showed me that these two parcels do in fact count towards that. Thank you.
Okay.
Square.
So,
ready for a vote?
Are we ready for a vote?
Do we click to come back, or we're good? We have enough?
We need six. We need six votes, so I think we'll be okay.
Okay.
Yeah. Well, one more point of discussion. Not to drag it out. Being on the Conservation Commission and doing conservation restrictions, it's similar. You said Sudbury Valley Trust. They don't do this because it's a athletic parcel. It's not really a conservation parcel. So, I feel a little bit uncomfortable that the restrictions going to be held by a private organization that is the people who are giving us the land. It's a corporation and they're giving us a gift, but then they're kind of holding the conservation restriction.
Yeah, that's a public private partnership on this whole project, I guess. And it's unusual.
But our legal team is good with it.
Our legal team has figured this out. They've spent a lot of time on trying to make sure that it would work. The problem is we would have to go through and amend the 500 acres probably through town meeting to take the numbers out of there.
What I mean is there another organization that could be...
Not that one can trust to uphold the town's interest. The town wants somebody that's willing to allow us to do stuff with this land.
Like the scouts or something.
You need an organization that isn't, when we want to build an athletic field.
They're going to say, good.
Yes. Right.
You know.
Charge us.
It'll be a public trust of some sort.
Thank you, sir, trust.
Okay, I think we're ready for a vote. All those in favor of that long motion that is in front of you, written all out on amending the master plan special permit, say yes.
Aye.
Aye. Aye. Anyone opposed? Anyone abstain?
I'm going to abstain because I wish that I had time to find out more information about other ways to have a conservation holder, but other than that, I'm not opposed to it. I'm just wishing there's a better answer.
Motion carries. Okay, sidewalk discussion. I got requests from DPW to clarify where we wanted to put sidewalks. I'm looking for the letter. I know Jen had given it to me here. Oh, it's a draft. Right. And the only changes that I would suggest we maybe make on her draft is that on Hayden Row, we want it on both sides of the street in that area, because that's what we're trying to do is to get the school so people aren't crossing out across.
Correct.
Mm-hmm.
And then the completion of small parts of the section of the town where they're missing throughout the town. He was looking for examples. I don't know whether people have examples that they would want to include, but I think just general like that. I mean, I can give you a couple that are off the top of my head, One is the Chestnut Hayden Rowe.
I think they fixed that, though, I thought you said, no?
No, they didn't.
They didn't. Oh, they only did a small piece of it?
They did close, but not all of it.
What's that?
At the Chestnut Hayden Rowe Street on the west side of the street, the sidewalk discontinues for about one bite by the guardrails.
Yeah.
Is it on Chestnut or on Hayden Rowe?
It would be on Hayden Rowe. At Chestnut.
I have
on the west side.
I have one to add maybe to that. And it, this was to David's point back maybe three meetings ago or four. The new highway department has a guardrail area that stops the sidewalk from going. If we extended a culvert over that, we would be able to continue that sidewalk.
We're,
I don't know.
We're on Wood Street, are we talking?
Yeah, on Wood Street.
Well, there was a combination between, let's say, Wood Street to the highway barn. Because remember, we left out that part.
Right,
that
one section. From where to where?
It's from, in front of the church.
From the church to the highway barn.
East to the highway barn.
Yes.
Okay. And another one that I just know, just because I drive by it almost every day, Levin Wild Drive, I guess. It's just one house that just never got a sidewalk. I mean, it's...
Which one's that in Wild?
It's off the Chestnut.
It's kind of almost...
I know of Wild.
It's kind of... It's the plumber used to own it.
Okay, I know. Yeah.
I mean, it's got a nice picket fence in front of it.
Yes.
And the whole bit. And,
yes.
And... The whole rest of the subdivision is all sidewalk except for that one particular house. And I mean, you know, it just doesn't make sense.
So also I have one Foot Street, the beginning to the end. Does that count as a small section?
Yeah, not quite.
Street beginning to the end.
I mean,
yeah. Yeah,
you know,
small sections.
Small sections, I think we're defining as 100 feet here and 100 feet there, you know, that completes something else, you
there
know.
You go. Oh, I have another one. Auciello Drive to.
Laurel Road. One question on that, Mr. Chairman. There. Yeah. Is that within the context of the financial budget?
That, see, this is what he's trying to do. Is he's got some engineering money.
Yes.
And so they're basically looking at where they want to do it, and then from this he's going to put together here. Here's my budget. One, to either design them, and two, cost them all out, and then they're going to go to town meeting.
This isn't this is the $310,000 I thought that was left over from.
From my understanding, my conversation with him, he's now working on his capital expense projects for town meeting.
Okay.
So
right.
These would be construction monies for these roads.
New ones.
Yeah,
I believe.
Yeah. This will be all new sidewalk. Some of the stuff he's doing by Legacy. To Clinton Street in going completing kind of that loop along East Main Street. I think he said to me that's going to be construction in the spring.
And to this point, Ken, we have the other draft for the recent incident with.
We'll get to that.
Okay,
that's kind of next. So basically, I don't know.
Okay, I'll make those changes and then have you come in and sign.
Nobody has a problem with that. I mean, that's a...
So, no. Just to clear about the process, he's looking at adding these to town meeting?
Eventually, he's looking at the budget.
He's looking for putting in capital expense project for town meeting, whether or not he's going to be specific about that. But he was asking for clarification on your previous recommendations.
Thank you.
Yep.
And just a question on that. Based on the survey, these ones here, did they fall within the top three or four?
The first two did, The small sections was more of your recommendation, but the West Main and the Hayden Row were in, I think, the top three or top four.
And the Wood Street was also in our discussions earlier.
Right, but I don't think it was high on the survey.
Correct.
That section was just a smaller
right.
section.
Yeah, right.
You know,
right.
It goes to here.
Right.
We put the sidewalk in front of the DPW garage. We'd look a lot better if it made it at least to that part, you know, maybe the next round we'll get it all the way to Woodville.
Yeah, there's only two substantial ones. Yes. The two substantial are Hayden Row and West Main Street.
Yeah. Okay, so let's...
Chestnut.
So, okay.
Chestnut out there, David.
Okay, so everyone seems pretty comfortable with the letter.
Just for clarification, Ken.
Yeah.
With the easement that we have to take the right-hand turn onto Lumber Street coming from 495, that sidewalk area is going to be, that's an under a whole different...
That would be under reconstruction of that intersection.
could Frank just add a point that I wasn't following him on?
Okay.
Could you just explain?
So the ones on the top list, there were top two. One of the top two was going from Chestnut down to Ash.
Are you talking about on the survey? The
survey.
Okay.
Right.
Yeah, but that's not. We're
no,
not
I
having
didn't.
That.
We,
okay.
We I think we determined before that going along West Main Street was our number one priority, and then Hayden Row. After we kind of went through the school.
Right. So the Hayden Row, we took Ken's point, we did outside the survey because of the new school
moved.
And particularly.
Okay, thanks, Frank.
Yeah. Okay, so we've got that draft. Then we have another draft in here on Hayden Row talking about really looking at the corridor. And I think we need to add one more paragraph that says something like the school or traffic calming measure was introduced at the town meeting and defeated a couple years ago, I believe, and that's another reason why we need to put why this is time to do it. I mean, the idea was a good idea, it just wasn't explained well enough at town meeting that that people felt comfortable voting. We couldn't even figure out what was in the scope at the time. So I think with that adding it into that, this would then talk about it. Maybe we'll take the light of the recent motor accident, maybe move that down to second or third, as opposed to leading with that particular unfortunate incident, because the two other ones are probably even more important. And I'm not sure that if the road had been redesigned,
That would have prevented
that or not.
No.
If you're a distracted driver.
The person stopped for the crosswalk.
Yeah.
But we also have other incidences that have had happened there on Hayden Row.
Different location, but...
Yes.
But yeah. It's a tragic thing, but, I think we're looking at this recommendation for starting to do the engineering in that corner, and from basically we got three schools that I got caught in that traffic today, and it was just I'm glad I don't have to go through there every day. I mean, it's a tough one, and it really needs some engineering along that whole area.
Yeah, maybe we need to revisit that light idea.
Well, that. The light might make sense. Well,
the Chestnut.
But the problem is, there's so many intersections. There's so many intersections, right?
You
the new school, the old school.
You got to do it all at once,
or
you don't. You're wasting your money. Mm-hmm. And quite frankly, I think having somebody manually directing things. I mean, that light. I was stopped over at Grove Street intersection, waiting for a line of buses to come out of the high school.
Mm-hmm.
And I mean, a light couldn't have solved that problem.
No.
Turning lanes couldn't have solved that
when
problem.
When they let the buses go, you're there for like 5 minutes. We always try to get in before, because my daughter tried to get in before the buses, or out before the buses, but you can't. You're stuck.
Yep. So anyway.
The question here is to have the Board of Selectmen establish a budget fund an engineering study.
Right, that's our clear recommendation.
Right.
We will play around with a little bit on the words, but that's the concept. Everyone clear with, happy with that?
Yes.
Yeah.
Okay.
One typo.
Oh, yeah. Okay.
I don't know if it was caught by anyone else. Paragraph 2, right in the middle, second line, board added this area, I believe is what it's supposed to say.
I do that all the time. I usually catch myself.
Okay, so we're set on that. It's getting too late to talk about annual goals.
That seems to be our
motion to adjourn.
Not quite, please.
minutes.
You had a
no
you had a list of items that Zach is starting to look at. And It was on the paper in front of you guys today. I just wanted to call your attention to that. And looks like they've already voted to recommend about three items for the town meeting, so they're moving right along.
Very productive meeting, unless
I thank them all for their service, in advance of great service. I presented the two or three little ones that we were interested in worrying about.
After you left, Ken, I snuck in the third one from the bottom. Sidewalk construction standards.
Okay.
Prohibit roosters and residential.
So that
areas.
Is really a subdivision regulation.
Yep.
It's not a zoning bylaw.
They asked what I wanted to do with it, and I said I don't know, but stop building sidewalks at the same level as the street, and it's not just for subdivisions. It's all along Western Eighth Street, East Main Street.
Right, but it still would, I believe, belong in our subdivision regulations because.
But then you can't apply it.
Process.
To like,
no,
process.
You
can.
Sure.
Yeah. Okay.
Yeah.
Yeah. So I don't know the solution where to put it, but it's okay.
Discussion.
Yeah.
That is really subjective.
So you're saying it doesn't belong on their list?
The other thing that I thought about. Since I was talking to them, we had the assigned bylaw that didn't allow the Starbucks parking lot owner to put the sign, too many signs that said, you know, you couldn't park for very long. And I thought about it, you know, we approved all sorts of signs on the elementary school, which is a town project, and maybe you get around it, but basically, parking lot traffic signs shouldn't be into
the restricted area.
You shouldn't be restricted in number. If you need a one-way sign or you need a bank teller cues.
Right.
I
agree with you.
I mean, so anyway.
But that was because it was street facing. That was the reason I thought.
I slightly disagree because a parking lot is no different than anywhere else in town where you want to limit the number of signs to a reasonable amount. I'm not saying we should apply strict standards, but we should at least think about it.
But sure. How much would one individual put into a parking lot in the first place?
If
you're talking about adding 15 signs.
Well, I mean, if you've got...
Well, that would be every parking spot.
If you have compact... If you have compact parking spots,
sure.
you got to sign it.
Right,
you know,
short-term parking.
You've got all the handicapped ones, which are required by law. You've got the reserved for expectant mothers.
As I said
parking.
To the chairman earlier when he mentioned this to me.
Say it again.
That's content, and under the Supreme Court decision, Gilbert versus the state of Arizona. We cannot regulate content in our sign bylaw, and so we can't specifically say traffic signs are exempt. We can say signs regulated by local, state, and federal government, which is why we can say stop signs, fire lane signs, handicap signs, all of those signs can be exempt.
But
mother parking sign is not really... It's not a regulatory sign that we establish.
So it's open.
Maybe we need to establish some regulatory signs that people can use. I mean, or something. I mean, to me, this whole Supreme Court law was absolute nonsense.
To your point, I think the letter of the law and the spirit of the law kind of contradict in this instance. I mean, there are instances where it's nice to have a sign that says something that maybe the government didn't say we should put down, but...
Yeah. Make a smiley face.
No, but do they put in laws as to how many 20-minute parking signs you can put in the parking lot? Is there a statute on that?
On what?
How many 20-minute parking?
We have a bylaw that regularly says you can only have two accessory signs per lot, and they already had two because they had two for the Unibank drive-thru.
Could they take it down itself?
You went to Unibank.
Entertain the thought of changing that, because I do believe that
you could change. You could say you could have five accessory signs per lot,
right.
But you have to consider, even on a 30,000 square foot lot.
Yeah, how many square feet footage?
Then maybe you put accessory signs per 100 square feet,
yeah,
or 1,000 square feet of parking area,
right,
or something
that
like that.
That makes sense.
Anyway, let's let Zach worry about that one.
Well,
we'll add
that
to the list.
No, I'm wrong because you're on Zach, but Elaine told me that Zach was not going to do any sign bylaws this year, or they did not want to do any.
So at our last meeting, we did talk about it was mentioned that if we could avoid talking about signs again this year, after the extent that we went through it last year, that would be great. There may be a need to discuss it again this year.
Elaine's comment to me was, "Why don't we let it sit for a year and see how it works?"
Well, to Ken's point, though, I do believe that signage should be, you know, workable for whoever is, you know, applying for that.
The problem is you're never going to make everybody happy with
no
signs.
I understand.
No,
it's,
we just make everybody happy.
And
Cliff,
you've got
we'll be talking about signs every year. There'll always be something to
yes,
change.
Yes, sure. No, I agree. But at some point, there's got to be a
half
balance.
What happened to that motion to adjourn?
Nobody seconded it.
You stopped
it. But the design review board is going to talk to 75 Main Street, and then they'll say, "Okay, we see your point. We don't see the things this is agreed. Yes, we'll give you your signs." I mean, that's how the process works, right? So if that doesn't work, then there's a problem we should fix. But if it does work, then we're fine.
Design review board makes a recommendation one way or another.
Yeah, they don't vote on anything.
Oh,
they recommend it to us, or they recommend it to...
Do we ever get anywhere with the no parking on sidewalks, no blocking?
No. Motion to adjourn?
I'm not going to be here on November 21st.
Well, last meeting, it came up.
Okay.
I think we're all okay with it.
That's my thing with my parents.
You should have put in...
But Elaine will be here to handle the public hearing for...
Okay.
Some...
So he's got a real good
motion
point.
Motion to adjourn?
No.
Move, second. Moved and seconded.
Discussion, please.
No,
I wasn't going to shut it off.
Are you ready for the vote to adjourn?
I already voted. Discussion? Just kidding.
All those in favor say aye.
Aye.
Anyone opposed? Anyone abstained? Motion carried.
So because I voted aye twice, that's 9 ayes.